Good morning, everyone.
Hi.
thank you all for coming. We're so glad that you're here, and we're really excited to have this opportunity to hear from some really incredible leaders in gun violence prevention. Before we get started, we'd like to make a few announcements. There's water at the four corners inside of the room here. The bathrooms are located outside of the back doors of the ballroom and to the left. There's a raffle set up on the side of the room. Please write your name on your raffle ticket and drop it into one of the jars. We will do the drawing at the end of the symposium, and you must be present at that time in order to win. We will be saving all questions for the end during the Q&A session for the panel. So please feel free to use the index cards that are on your table to keep track of your questions throughout the symposium.
It is such a pleasure for us to introduce Dr. Braddock, the Vice Dean for Education at the David Geffen School of Medicine at UCLA. He is our faculty advisor for this event, and there are not enough words to describe how helpful his insight and guidance have been in planning the symposium from day one. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Braddock to the stage.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Very good. Well, it's just such a delight to welcome everyone here for the 21st Healthcare Symposium. We're really in debt to the wonderful work of our students, who you'll hear a little bit more about in a moment, to our speakers, and to all of you for being here. A little bit about the Healthcare Symposium. It's the 21st annual, and it began really 21 years ago as an idea, a way for medical students to take issues that they've been exposed to in the course of their medical training and explore them in more depth. Lots of issues like that arise in biomedicine at the frontiers of biomedical research, but in the past several years, we've tried to expand that scope to think about issues that are beyond biomedicine strictly, that have to do with public health, the health of our communities, and our roles as healthcare professionals. And it's in that spirit that today's topic couldn't be a better exemplar of that focus, the focus on gun violence. I want to thank in particular, again, you hear more about them, Angie, Cher, Mari, Sarah, and Tiffany. You guys have been phenomenal. My job as faculty advisor was largely to kind of unleash them and let them go. And you'll see that today in the program and all the logistics and in the wonderful work you've done. So I thank you all for your tremendous work. I also want to thank our esteemed guests. We're truly honored and grateful for what really is kind of an all-star cast of leading voices in this area, which you'll hear over the course of the morning. And it's, I think, a testament to the importance of this issue and to the efforts of our student leaders that we were able to assemble such a wonderful group. And I also want to thank all of you in the audience. Just out of curiosity, how many medical students here? Nursing students? Dental students, public health, faculty in any of our schools, staff, members of the community. Fabulous. Well, again, thank you so much for coming to what I hope will be a very inspiring and energizing morning. The Healthcare Symposium, as I said, has shifted its emphasis in prior years to try to actively engage our medical students in leading in trying to bring to light issues of importance to society that affect health. And that really captures our belief that we want our medical students to be world leaders in health and science. I'm going to say that again, world leaders in health and science. Yes, we want them to be outstanding physicians, don't get me wrong, but we also want them to have experiences and the passion to channel that energy into actually improving health. And we share that legacy with all the other health profession schools, with our partners at Charles R. Drew University for Medicine and Science, and with the broader Los Angeles community. And this is a particularly important kind of conference because it's a conference about issues that affect all of us, whether directly or indirectly, whether because of personal experience or by just what we see in the world. We have an opportunity today to think together carefully and to take today not just as an interesting series of talks, but as a call to action. There are a lot of words that have been used for this in recent months. Terms like lean in, right, resist, persist. My message to all of us today is to be energized and to think about how we can, now more than ever, think about ways that we can engage in civic discourse, in civic engagement, not just as citizens, but as current or future healthcare professionals. We have an obligation, not just in the case of medicine, not just to the patient and family in front of us, but to the broader community, to speak out for issues like the issue today that affect the health of our patients, our communities, and our country. This kind of engagement is part of our broader effort in medicine and the medical school that we share with other schools in trying to create opportunities for students to really realize their passions in a way that can impact health. So that's your job today. Be engaged. And from today, to carry forth what we talk about today into action. So next I'd like to introduce our moderator for today, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. David Carlisle, President and CEO of Charles R. Drew University of Medicine and Science. Most of you know that we've enjoyed a long and rich partnership with Charles R. Drew University in many ways, most notably our Charles R. Drew UCLA Medical Education Program, in which students are jointly recruited into a program that's shared between the two institutions, in which students deeply engaged and interested in the care of urban underserved come into medical school, bringing that mission and passion to what they do in medical school and beyond. And it's a long-standing partnership that has enriched both our institutions. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Carlisle.
Let's try it again. Good morning, everyone. Okay, I think we're waking up and there's more coffee on the side there. Yes, it is indeed a great pleasure to be here with you. This symposium is a wonderful thing that the students put on every year, and they don't shy away from controversial topics, and today's topic is no less controversial, and indeed is a very important topic. I do want to bring it, make it a little bit more personal by reading some names to you. And I'll start with the name of Karen Toshima. And some of you may remember Karen Toshima, shot in Westwood Village, died in February of 1988. Her death galvanized, I think, LA's realization about gun violence. Latasha Harlins, we all know about the Rodney King violence that precipitated the revolt that occurred in Los Angeles in 1992. Well, those of us who are in the community, no, it was really the shooting death of Latasha Harlins that focused the community on wasteful gun violence and deaths that occurred when she was killed at the age of 15. Alexander Emeke Anene, just last year, a graduate of the CDU Public Health Program, shot and killed in the Athens community of Los Angeles. Of course, UCLA professor William Klug, age 39, professor of engineering, shot and killed June of 2016 on this campus. Dion Leonard Moss. The reason this is important to me is I was in my office at 4:30 on a Thursday afternoon, December 7th, and I heard gunshots, eight, break out. Went downstairs, the sheriff's deputies were already there, a block away from our campus on the corner of 118th Street and Compton Avenue. Dion Leonard Moss lost his life. So this is an issue that is a personal issue, and the reason I wanted to personalize it is we need to recognize that these are daughters, mothers, fathers, brothers, sons who are dying every day in this community of gun violence. But it's obviously not just Los Angeles. Chicago, 2016, 762 gun deaths. Rio de Janeiro, despite the Olympics, 15 homicides a day. And of course, we have extrajudicial killings going on in the Philippines. We have the situation in Ukraine. I could go on and on. I could mention Syria. This is a public health challenge that we're facing. And that's why it is a great pleasure for me to introduce one of our country's public health leaders on this topic. Somebody who is near and dear to me. because she is our dean and professor of medicine at the Charles R. Drew University, dean of the College of Medicine. She has a wealth of experience in violence prevention as a physician, working with vulnerable populations, as an author of multiple books, as a leader in public health, including acting as the first woman to serve as commissioner of public health for the state of Massachusetts. I think the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, correct? Okay. Today, she is here to provide us with a broad overview of our topic and a framework on how to consider the intersection between gun violence, social justice, and healthcare based on our vast experience. I introduce to you Dean Dr. Deborah Prothro-Stith.
Good morning. What an honor it is to be here. I, too, have to add my thanks to the students for not only organizing such a wonderful event, but also for really selecting this topic. Even though some of us have been working on this issue for you know, when you get asked to do a retrospective, that means that means you've been around for a while, and there are some of us who have actually been working on this for decades. And even though that's been going on within health and within public health, it's exciting to see the leaders of today and tomorrow, our students, really embrace this this subject. It's such an important one for us. So let's get started with this retrospective. I will say that each of us who has been around for a while working on this issue came to it for a variety of reasons, personal experiences, the passion, some because of family experiences, and bringing that to a public health agenda or a larger health agenda is a real privilege. So for the medical students, I do want to say, and the nursing students, and the pharmacy students, and the dental students, that your passion will emerge in your training, and your personal experiences can inform your professional choices in a way that can lead to an amazing career and the opportunity to make some contribution. So I encourage you, as you talk to us individually after and over the break, to ask about those personal experiences and that passion that we have for this, this subject. So let's get started here. One of the things when I'm thinking back on the really three decades and some that we've been working on this issue, there's some lessons learned. And so as I think back over that, I want to share these lessons. One is that history is important, and it's particularly important to the ecological model that public health really embraces these days. And as we understand social justice as a part of our mission as healthcare providers, we tend to leave out history. And one of the things that struck me when I came across this poster at the African American Museum on Joy Street in Boston, if you're ever there, you want to visit, was that in our efforts to build police-community relationships, you know, deal with the Don't Snitch campaign, we really didn't have a good historical basis. This poster is an 1851 placard that was posted around Boston cautioning the colored people of Boston to respectfully avoid conversing with watchmen and police officers because there had been an order of the mayor and aldermen that asked the watchmen and the police officers to kidnap and re-catch slaves. You might have seen the movie 12 Years a Slave. The poster ends, you know, keep a sharp lookout for the kidnappers and have a top eye open. And it advises community members to shun the police and not talk to them at all. So 1851 seems like a long time ago, but actually someone's, you know, great grandmother told somebody's grandfather, you know, told somebody, don't talk to the police. So when you are building community police relationships and you want to talk about don't snitch and address that so that the community members become partners with the police and actually do share what's going on, having this kind of history is extremely important. So I want to share that as one of the lessons learned, but also to set the stage to talk about some of the difficult issues that have come up as we've addressed this issue. So back in the early 80s, we found Mark Rosenberg at CDC, who was heading the violence epidemiology branch, and he was in an office with a quarter of an assistant in the basement. And he produced, with that set of resources, an MMWR, a Morbidity and Mortality Weekly, indicating that homicide was the leading cause of death for young black men. And for some of us who had started working on this issue, we immediately reached out to Mark and with him really started galvanizing people across the country to think about this issue. And Surgeon General Koop was Surgeon General at the time. And with his relationship with Mark, he hosted what we think is the first conference looking at violence as a public health problem. And that was 1985. And we gathered and were divided into categories: child abuse, gang violence, school violence, elder abuse, intimate partner violence, and really discuss some of the things that could be done. That really set the stage for us to start talking about why this is a public health problem. And we actually had to make the case, and we went around the country making the case, and at that time we said, it's a big problem, the magnitude of the problem. We also argued that the characteristics of the problem put it in a public health context. And by that, we meant that because many, if not most, of the violent episodes occur in the context of people who know each other. I was shocked to learn that about homicide, that so many of the homicides, and it was about 50%, occurs in the context of people who know each other, our acquaintances, our family members. If a woman is a victim of a homicide, that number is even higher. And what we were beginning to appreciate is that stiffer laws and mandatory sentences would not impact two people who knew each other, who got into an argument, who were drinking alcohol, and who had a handgun. And that was a pretty typical homicide setting. So we were saying this problem is not going to be completely addressed by the law enforcement, criminal justice community, enter public health. The contact, I have an emergency room story that is my entree into this arena. When a young man told me that he was going to be back in that emergency room, send the guy who cut him in for more stitches, that whole cycle of violence and revenge became clear to me. But whether it's oral surgeons or OBGYN, nurses and physicians, midwives, we have such tremendous contact with people who are victims and participants and perpetrators of violence. And then finally, we argue that public health strategies that have been used for drunk driving prevention, for teenage pregnancy prevention, for smoking prevention, that those same strategies would work for violence prevention. And then we were making an assumption. Now we've got pretty good evidence that that's in fact the case, that classroom education matters, that consumer groups matter, that mobilization in the community matters, that a mayor's office on violence prevention matters. So then we were making, in the early 80s, making an assumption, but over time, data has really borne us out. One of the things that really became a part of what we were doing when we said violence was a public health problem was declaring it as a preventable problem. So I didn't understand why we were just stitching people up and sending them out. And when that young man said to me, "Don't go to bed," I had no intervention. I just laughed with him as he left. I didn't understand why we were just stitching people up and sending them out, why we didn't have a prevention agenda for violence against oneself, suicide prevention. We had a prevention agenda. I had a protocol, but I had no protocol when he said he was gonna go out and get the guy who cut him. And in thinking about it, I figured we just didn't think that this was a preventable problem. So I think one of the huge contributions that public health has made over time in saying violence is a public health problem is the contribution of shifting the paradigm so that we think of it as a preventable problem. Well, this is one of the biggest pieces of evidence that that convinced me we were dealing with a preventable problem. Because clearly, the United States rates, which go up and down, but pretty significantly remain higher than the bars at the bottom, which is a collection of European and Asian oceanic countries, where the rates are pretty low and stable, that just convinced me that this wasn't some kind of genetic, inevitable part of the human condition. I mean, when you look at this with a public health lens, you say, okay, that country is doing something wrong, or there's some things that that country ought to do that it's not doing, or both. But you clearly begin to think about the preventable nature of this problem. And this is just another illustration of how we stand out among the world in our gun violence, our homicide rates. And you know, it's just pretty striking when you see that kind of discrepancy to start thinking about, so what is it that we are doing that we ought not do, or what are the things we ought to be doing that we're not doing? And certainly guns will come into the picture as you ponder that question and think about prevention. I want to take a minute to talk about this issue of justifiable homicide, because I have to admit that when we were pulling down the uniform crime reports from, you know, the Justice Department and looking at the violence rates, that up and down that you saw, there was always this sort of steady line of justifiable homicides. And defined by justice as the killing of a felony by a peace officer in the line of duty, or killing of a felon during the commission of a felony by a private citizen. So most of us, I included, just kind of ignore that steady line at the bottom until recently. And it's very interesting because that line was so steady. I mean, it was 300 to 400 a year. And this is the last few years of data. Now, I had a student working with me, and I have to give Erin Johnson a little shout out here. And I asked her to get the racial breakdown of this justifiable homicide number. And I remember that it was there a couple of decades ago when we were looking at it. It was 85% black, 85% African American. But she couldn't find the numbers, so I don't know if it's been taken down or what. But this area of study becomes very interesting when we start thinking about what has occurred recently in our country. And it's not that these police on black and brown men episodes of violence, it's not that they are new. It's that we have cameras now. And now we believe some of the stories that we heard before. People in the community were always saying, the police did this, he didn't have a gun, he wasn't doing anything wrong. They were saying that. But without cameras, I'm not sure they were believed. I'm pretty sure at the policy level, we didn't believe it. But as an area of study now, I think that 300 to 500, usually about 400 a year, events called justifiable homicide deserve a little more epidemiology and a little more investigative look from the health perspective. Well, I mentioned that it means that it's a preventable problem when we say violence is a public health problem, but it also means that what we can do in health and in public health is quite complementary to what is offered in criminal justice. And interestingly, there were a few instances where we kind of got into some turf issues historically. And I found this kind of layout of the issue very helpful for sort of illustrating how disciplines can come together to work on this problem. One of the things that I was often asked when we were in the classroom teaching violence prevention and anger management was, how do you expect a gang member who shot somebody to benefit from an anger management lesson in high school? Well, if you think about this up front, in the thick, after the fact, or primary, secondary, tertiary, or universal, selected, targeted, some of the language that we use in public health, these labels up front, in the thick, and after the fact came from some teenagers in Philadelphia. I was sort of describing primary, secondary, tertiary prevention, and they reframed it for me, and I really like their labels. But if you think about this, a classroom intervention on anger is primary prevention. It's universal. It's for all of us. We all get angry. We all could benefit from how to handle those situations. But a gang member who shot somebody is literally after the fact. And those strategies and interventions are very different. I think about smoking when I think about this kind of analogy. And if we were trying to prevent lung cancer, the after the fact strategies after you have lung cancer would be surgery and chemotherapy and it's a different professional skill set that you need. If we wanted to prevent lung cancer, we wouldn't call that skill set to the table. We would talk about the people who educate us on the impact of smoking, who keep people who don't smoke from starting. I remember buying those little candy cigarettes and standing in front of the television, imitating all the beautiful people. I know it's hard for some of you to even imagine a world where smoking was glamorous and everybody on television was smoking, but that was the world I grew up in. And interestingly, up front is what worked to change attitudes and social norms. And then in the thick would be what we do with people who smoke so they stop. And that gets into behavior modification and hypnosis and Nicorette gum and all kinds of other strategies. But the other part of this chart, the purple, really reflects the work of public health in an interdisciplinary way. And the white really reflects the work of criminal justice. And one of the major points and one of the lessons learned over the years is that these strategies, these disciplines, are quite complementary. The other thing, though, is that where we fail as a society is in the thick. So we stitch these kids up and we send them out. We expel them from school regularly. The police see them when they've watched their mother beaten and they're hidden in the closet or under the sofa. The clergy will see them out on the streets. We know these kids. We see them regularly. We understand their risk. And neither public health or that interdisciplinary group nor criminal justice really does a good job there. We still, as a society, wait until they are after the fact before we begin to spend money. The risk factors supported by the literature are significant. We're going to hear more about access to guns, but it's worth mentioning all of these risk factors. I really focus in on the culture of violence. It's the thing that has impressed me over time, because even the guns in this society exist in the context of a culture, and how we have them and how we use them becomes a part of our context and our problem. Thinking about those risk factors as they impact individuals, it's also important to appreciate that the impact, both risk and resiliency, have impact at a variety of levels. It's not enough to have a healthy child in a healthy family, because if the society is unhealthy, and particularly during those adolescent years, you can start getting some bad outcomes. And I do remember a father interviewed by a reporter. It was a gripping interview. His son had been murdered. And the reporter said, "You did everything right. Your son was an athlete and a scholar and headed to college and well-liked, and he was killed. You did everything right, and he was killed." And the father looked up and said, "I forgot to raise the other children." And in some ways, it really is at each of these levels that we have to address this, this problem. The other thing that convinced us that this was a preventable problem was our experience in Boston. And at the height, you remember back to that chart where the U.S. blue line went up and down. Well, there was a point at which we were in the middle of an epidemic as a country. We still have a very big problem, an endemic problem. But at that point, which was kind of the late 80s, early 90s, we were having one homicide a month of a child 16 or younger with a gun in Boston. And there are a couple of names that still resonate with me and those in Boston, Tiffany Moore being one of them. But in many ways, that was horrible, intolerable. And over time, that number went down to zero. And it stayed zero for about 4 years. And then ticked up a little bit. It's not gotten back to that number. But why becomes a big question. Well, one of the lessons that we learned is that it is truly that accumulation of programs that you see in the background, that step-wise illustration of the programs that came into play that mattered. We say there's no one program, and of course, there are some programs who say, "We did that," you know. But the truth is that As a city, Boston started addressing this issue, and many people played a role, whether it was the Boys and Girls Clubs, education in the classroom, the street youth outreach workers. The mayor's initiative included 125 street youth outreach workers, and they would go out and between midnight and 2 and 3 in the morning, reaching out to young people. And I think they were one of the most effective aspects of this activity. But it also included the media. The 10-Point Coalition was a group of clergy. Ceasefire is one of the programs where the police and the community and the clergy worked together. No one program, but it involved everyone, and I think this is just an important lesson. If we're trying to use the ecological model to begin to address something as complicated as this issue of violence, we really have to use all of the resources and work at all of those levels. I want to close with one of the final lessons that I learned. It was a real aha moment, and I mentioned that the culture of the list of risk factors for me has become my passion. It's where I think as a society we can make some real headway. But again, history, I was sort of late to appreciating the impact of history, but this history of dueling in America is quite interesting and can really inform some of the thinking. Dueling was so much a part of the culture between sort of the early 1800s, really to the late and early late 1800s, early 1900s. That twin pistols were created so that the duel would be fair, so that, and these were orchestrated events. They weren't just an impulsive eruption of anger. It was 3 o'clock on Sunday in the Commons that people would come to watch this duel. And interestingly, they were illegal, which is another really interesting point here. Every time you see a state here in red, it is the passage of a law saying that dueling is illegal and saying that elected officials cannot hold office if, in fact, they have a history of dueling. Despite that, you'll see at the bottom here, South Carolina, the governor actually wrote the European code came over of how and the laws and the guidelines for dueling. And so the South Carolina governor rewrote that so that it applied to the United States. And it's interesting that it was illegal, yet so much a part of the culture. Women were told that they shouldn't marry a man unless he had proven himself with a blade. That's how much a part of this culture that dueling was. Interestingly, the Civil War seemed to be the point at which the dueling started to wane. And if there's any good news in this, it's that dueling as a phenomenon went away. There's some other things that might have replaced it. But interestingly, the culture can change. Bloody Island, because it was illegal, people had to find places to duel because it wasn't something you could just do. Well, in New Orleans, you could just do it in the park and schedule it on Sunday, which is another item. But there were designated places like Bloody Island in the Mississippi. And these duels were about insults. So this reads, the object of this placard is to inform the public that General Lee Reed has declined giving to me an apology for the insult offered me at St. Mark's, that he has also refused to me that satisfaction, which as an honorable man, he was bound to give, I therefore pronounce him a coward and a scoundrel. Now, this pronouncing that you're a coward and a scoundrel was the beginning of the duel, in the sense that your mediator or second would then go and ask for that apology, and then there was a scripted way, according to the code, that you would go back and forth, and how many times you would go back and forth, and if it didn't, the apology didn't happen, or people weren't satisfied, then the seconds would set up this this duel. But this is an insult, and you had to be a gentleman. So this isn't about homicide. This is about dueling. You had to be a gentleman. Now, one of the students at the Harvard School of Public Health put together a registry of dueling, and out of like 508 that he was able to uncover, one was a woman, actually, and one was a black man. But other than that, the other 582 of them were elite white gentlemen, because that was by definition what was required for a duel. And they were pretty common. This is just several accounts. Fox Butterfield's book, All God's Children, I recommend to you if you are interested in this area. But he counts that the rate of dueling and homicide from dueling in South Carolina was about 18 per 100,000 per year. And again, you remember that blue up and down? Well, 18 is one of the ups on that blue line, one of the ups, one of the epidemic, not the endemic part. So this was a pretty substantial part of our culture. Well, when I learned that Alexander Hamilton was killed in a duel, and I learned that he wrote in his diary the night before he was killed why he should and shouldn't duel, I became very, very interested. And what he wrote was that he had a wife and children, he was love them, that he was deeply in debt and didn't want to leave them that debt, that he bore no ill will to Aaron Burr, that it was illegal in New York, this was a lawmaker, right, and that it was condemned by Christianity. He wrote why he should, pressing necessity not to decline the call, well, that's called peer pressure, that it would cost him political support, that's my posse won't hang with me if I don't fight, and that it was essential to his ability to be useful in the future. So that's, you know, they're going to take my lunch money every day if I don't beat them up. The utility of fighting. But the interesting thing is Alexander Hamilton's son was killed in a duel in 1801. So 3 years before, he, despite having all these reasons not to, woke up and took a boat to Weehawken, New Jersey, the bloody island of the Northeast, and was killed in a duel. And one of the lessons to me in that is that if Alexander Hamilton couldn't resist, I'm not exactly sure how we expect our young black and brown youth in very, very difficult circumstances to resist. And changing that culture is part of our work. It is a part of the necessary work we have to do. Finally, one lesson that I must share is that we don't know it all. Even when we get the best epidemiology, even when we get the best scientists at the table, we really have to listen. And my aha moment was when a friend asked me to come and meet a man who had a program called Boxing Out the Violence. And I said, I'm not meeting anybody with a program about boxing. Boxing is part of the problem, it is not part of the solution. And the friend said, but you know, he's a friend of my mother's, and I really, if you could just meet with him. So we set up a meeting, And in walks this 75-year-old, very charismatic, retired boxer who had an amazing program. And basically, he said, I could take any youth in South Boston, Roxbury, anybody here in Boston, and if I get them interested, I can get them in the gym and I can teach them nonviolence. And my aha moment in that was that if he had come to me with a martial arts and violence prevention program, I would have responded very differently. There was an elitism in my response. And then I appreciated that had I been a funder, I would not have even read his proposal. So as we began to reach out and get people who are necessary parts of our effort, remember that we have to learn from them and have them contribute, because even at our best, as a health provider, as a public health practitioner, as an outreach worker, even at our best, we don't know enough without that partnership. So that's the final lesson that I'm sharing today, and I look forward to the rest of the conversation. Thank you.
Well, now it's a great honor to follow that wonderful presentation by Dr. Deborah Prothro-Stith with our next speaker. And I just want to say it's a real honor to welcome Mr. Ben Owens to the symposium. He's a former gang member who turned activist, who has experienced firsthand the culture of gun violence. He's the founder of the Detours Mentoring Group and is involved in a variety of community organizations right here in Los Angeles that bring awareness and work to resolve gun violence and gang violence. Mr. Owens, thank you so much for being here today to share your personal journey with us and to inspire us to be advocates for this cause.
Good morning. Well, first of all, thank you for the invite. It's an honor. It's a pleasure to be here. This is the clicker I'm going to be using. Let's see. Go again. I want to say thank you for the invitation to be here this morning. I want to say thank you to Cher. She was real adamant about getting me here, made sure I had everything taken care of, and the team, you're just awesome. So again, thank you for the invitation. Also, thank you for everyone else that has considered for me to be here. There's so many prestigious people in here that I actually know and see in the community that does great work. I actually have a cheerleader here out there somewhere. Where's Billy Weiss? Billy Weiss, that's my mentor. Yes, I have a woman as a mentor. That's my mentor. Now, she's a little lady, but she's feisty, so don't mess with her. I titled my conversation, my story, More Than 100 Days and 100 Nights, as a result of something that occurred in Los Angeles, actually nationally, in 2015. Is anyone familiar with 100 Days and 100 Nights, a theme that kind of went on the social media? Well, I wanted to talk about this in particular because it was intriguing to me. I had been doing gang intervention work for a while, but in the summer of 2015, the city of Los Angeles had drawn national attention as a result of social media threat. This was just a threat for the most part, of a wave of 100 days and 100 nights of killings. But before I get into that discussion, that conversation, let me give you a backdrop, a little bit about me and part of how gang membership or gang people get involved with gangs to begin with. I grew up in a small city called Gardena. It's adjacent to South LA. We lived on a cul-de-sac. We called it a dead end, but I guess it's called a cul-de-sac these days. Now, in that home, that cul-de-sac, we had a well-manicured front lawn, and I lived there with my mother, my stepfather, my older brother, my younger sister, and my younger brother. I was a middle child. We lived in that home. My siblings and myself, we all watched the same cartoons. We ate the same cereal. We played with the same toys. We went to the same elementary school. But I was the only family member that joined the gang. In that cul-de-sac, in that home with the well-manicured front lawn, it was a dream. But sometimes that dream turned into nightmare on Elm Street, because there would be times where my stepfather would turn into something else because of his drinking. And his drinking would create problems for us on the weekend, very traumatic problems. And at the age of about 5, 6, 7 years old, Saturday nights, all of the kids would be put to bed and, you know, lights turned off, and eventually we'll hear our parents arguing. And at some point, that arguing would lead to fighting. I would get up out of the bed and I'd go in the closet. I didn't want to hear it. I could hear the fighting, but I didn't want to hear it. So I got in the closet and I closed the closet door and I sat in the dark. And if I had to use the bathroom, I would just pee on myself. I wouldn't leave the closet, because my mother had warned me, if you come out of that room, you're going to get the beating that you don't want. And so that went on. And the only thing that I could think of at that point as an 8, 9, 10-year-old was a prayer. And my prayer was that my mother would stop getting beaten. Or at least that my stepfather, now this was the man, the only man that I had ever called daddy. Now, let me go back a little bit, because I was introduced as Ben Owens, and there is a nickname associated with that, and that's Taco. Now, Taco was a childhood nickname that I grew up with. It's just not an acronym for anything. You can't jumble the letters around and it means anything special. It's just a childhood nickname. That's it, that's all. But my full name is Ben Owens III, Ben Owens III, which implies that there is a Ben Owens Jr., there's a Ben Owens Sr. And I got the identity of Taco as a childhood nickname because of my disconnection with Ben Owens. I didn't want to be Ben Owens because I didn't know who he was. I didn't know who Ben Owens Jr. was. I didn't know who my grandfather was. And so when I would do my schoolwork and I turn it in and the teachers say, oh, Ben Owens III, you're the third. Oh, that's so awesome. That's cool. Tell me about your dad. I couldn't tell her what his favorite color was. I couldn't tell her when his birthday was. I couldn't even tell her what he looked like, because I didn't know my biological father. I didn't know who he was. And part of that was because it's obvious that my parents weren't together. I had a stepfather. But I know I look older than what I am, but let me put it out there. I was born in the 60s. And you're probably still wondering, well, this guy's name is Ben Owens. So I have Ben is a Hebrew name, and Owens is an Irish name, and Taco was a Mexican name. What's going on with this guy? I was born in the 60s. My mother's Choctaw Indian, my father's black. My father's from Alabama, my mother's from Oklahoma. Up until 1967, it was illegal for interracial marriage. My father loved my mother. They loved each other. But there was a system created that didn't allow them, didn't afford them to have a marriage. So they didn't get married. I was born, my sister was born. Some way, well, somehow, they migrated to California. Things didn't work out. They ended up not being together anymore, and my mother got with my stepfather. They had met at the post office because that's where she worked. So again, this was a person that, although I hated what he did, I loved him because he was, to me, my daddy. He took care of me. He made sure I was fed and clothed. taught me different things, but we never had a father-son bond, but this is the only man that I ever called daddy. And so my prayers were that he would stop beating my mother, that my mother would either leave at some point or something would change, but those prayers were never answered. Never got the answer to that prayer. So I began to seek other sources of power. Where can I find some power? This has to stop. I'm tired of it. So I was exposed to this thing called TV. And a lot of you are young in here, but we used to have TV. Some of them wouldn't be color, or some of them would have this thing on it called a knob. A knob. And you, if you were the child, you were one of the remote controls. So when the channel had to be turned, that means you get up and turn it. And if things were real bad, you would be the antenna also to make sure that signal came in. Now, I was exposed to TV drama, and on that TV drama, in my young mind, I found a new form of power and violence. Watching TV drama gave me the insight that people could resolve their problems with guns within an instant. I seen it on TV. Somebody got mad at somebody. Somebody was trying to be a hero, and they pulled a gun out, and they killed somebody. So guns were intriguing to me. The power of the gun logic blended in my mind also with what my mother had always taught my brothers and my sister and myself. She said, if somebody hits you, you guys know the rest, what do? Hit them back. Hit them back. If somebody hits you, hit them back. In my young mind, I kind of interpret that as get revenge. If somebody offends you, somebody does something to you, hit them back, get revenge. And so I thought that my stepfather beating my mother meant that there needed to be consequences. He needed to get hit back. Something needed to happen to him. So I said, okay, a gun will be good. So I began to change my Christmas list. And on my Christmas list at the top, I will put down a BB gun. I wanted a BB gun for Christmas. For several Christmases, I would put it down on there. I need a BB gun. I want a BB gun. I don't know how you kill somebody with a BB gun, but I wanted it, and I wanted it bad. I never got the BB gun, but one Christmas, I went under the tree, and there was this long box, and I said, okay, I got it. And I opened it up, and it was an air gun. An air gun. Now, an air gun looks like almost like a real gun. It looks like a BB gun, but all it does is shoot out puffs of air. So that wasn't enough for me. So I took that air gun and I said, I'm going to modify this. I'm going to enhance it. It needs to look like the real deal, because one of these days I'm going to just run out the room and I'm going to get my stepfather. So I cut off the stock of the air gun and the barrel. Now I had me a little mini shotgun, sawed-off shotgun, what was an air gun that could have gotten me killed. My mother found that gun and she smashed it to pieces, and I was back in the laboratory finding ways to find me some power. I began to look at other options which I believe would give me the courage to face my stepfather. I believe having big muscles would get me somewhere, and I could probably go in there and deal with him if I had big muscles, so I began to lift weights. I played tackle football. Now, we lived on the cul-de-sac on a dead-end street, but you haven't played football in South L.A. until you played tackle football in the street with no pads, no helmets, and that's probably why I'm kind of in the condition I'm in today, but we would play tackle football in the street on the concrete because I wanted to be tough. And I said, if I get tough enough, I can handle some of his blows, but that didn't do it. So I even dedicated myself to practice karate. Now, at this time, era in my life, I didn't really need to go to karate school because there was a series of karate movies that came out. Bruce Lee, he would have movies that came out. And I had an older brother. He was 4 years older than me, so he kind of taught me karate because we'd watch a Bruce Lee movie, and he'd come and say, let me try this roundhouse kick on you and see if you can block it. So I had to learn karate by default, blocking those roundhouse kicks that he had for me. That still didn't help. I couldn't master the karate, so. But at 11 years old, I still didn't have the courage or the power to defeat my stepfather. Then one day, I was at school, I was in elementary school, and during recess. Now, recess was a time where we had our own personal time to play. We go out to the playground and we're playing kickball and whatever kids do on recess time, and this is our time. And I didn't own a watch at that time. I was a young boy. I didn't own a watch. I didn't need one. I wasn't going anywhere, but didn't own a watch. But this one particular day, my recess, my playtime was interrupted, and I didn't like that. Now, I was used to them having earthquake drills and everybody getting outside and lining up, but this particular day, they blew the whistles and the bells, and the teachers came out, and the teacher's aide, and even the principal came out and said, all right, it's time to go back in, it's time to go back in. And I'm thinking, no, it's not. We still got more time to play. They're gathering us together, say, Harry, get in the class, get in the class. And I'm thinking, there's something going on. And as we're hurrying back in class, I overheard a teacher say, the Crips are coming, the Crips are coming. Now, our school was adjacent to the playground, and the playground was adjacent to an alley. And as soon as she said that the Crips are coming, I peeked around the door, and I saw about 100 young men walking through the alley. Some of them had their shirts off, and they had these big muscles, and you could see their tattoos. Now, I know tattoos are kind of real popular back then, but you were considered tough back then if you had a tattoo. It was almost like if you had went to war somewhere and came back. It was, you had a tattoo, you were a tough guy. Now, these guys, they were marching through the alley. It was about 100 of them. And the way how they would stride together, in uniform together, it was if they had a purpose for being there. And they had somewhere to go. They had somewhere to be. And it didn't look like anybody was going to stop them. I took a look at that, and I took into account that that's power. Anybody, anything that could shut down my playtime, my recess time, demanded my respect because they had authority, they had power. I had a friend in the classroom, and his brother was a Crip, and he told me, you know, I'll introduce you to my brother. He's a Crip. And okay, you get to know him. I met him the next day and I became a Crip. I became a gang member. Now, being a gang member, in my mind, I said, this is going to give me leverage. And now I got some power. I'll come up with some kind of strategy to use this power to defeat my stepfather. At the age of 12, my agenda was to determine how to resolve this domestic crisis. By the time I was 13, I was in juvenile hall. Then I made it to camp. While I was there, my mother and my stepfather separated and eventually got a divorce. I was in camp because that was inadvertently informed to me that that was my rites of passage through the gang culture, meaning that I had signed up for going to jail at least for one day or one lifetime. Me being in the gang, I was informed inadvertently that it meant that I needed to commit a crime or two. It meant that I needed to be shot, stabbed, beat up, or even killed at least one time in my life. And so I was in camp, and I lifted weights, and I did everything that people thought that needed to happen in camp, and that was really one thing that I checked off on my to-do list. Because when you're in a gang, they give you a to-do list. You need to do this, this, and this, and this. And so going to camp, that was scratched off of my to-do list. When I got out of juvenile hall, I was basically homeless at that point because my mother had relocated to Sacramento. My stepfather, he was local, but we didn't talk that much, so we didn't have that much engagement, so I would stay with friends, or I would stay, you know, with other family members every now and then. But for the most part, I was homeless, and I would try to get around the best that I could. And then eventually, I was in love with someone, my childhood sweetheart, and we got married on my 19th birthday. my 19th birthday, we were married. By the time I was 20, I was in state prison serving 3 years for a drug sale. I was a father of two. I was married. I was a gang member. I was in prison. I got out at the age of 22, still a gang member, still a father of two, still married. In January 1989, I was out and fresh out. I went to Riverside to go visit some friends, and we're in the house and we're talking, and I needed to go out to the car, go get something. I went to the car and I headed to my way back to the apartment where we're at, and I heard someone yell out my name. They called my name. I couldn't really see who it was. They were about 50 yards away, but I figured that must be my friends. Maybe they went over here. I need to go over there and catch up with them. But as I got closer, I said, well, I don't know who that is. And then even as I got a little bit closer, I realized that those were enemies of my neighborhood. Now, I'm from Gardena. The neighborhood that I was from is in Gardena, but during the crack era, it was real lucrative to go to Riverside and make money. So the gang had an offshoot branch of the gang in Riverside. And while I was away in prison, they had set up shop, and in setting up shop, they had also made some enemies. I kind of heard about it, didn't know who it was with, but it was apparently these people that I was walking towards. I had an option of turning around, but there was no turning around at that point. I had already made a decision that I was going to go there, and I was there. So I went, and as I approached them, I'm kind of sizing them up. It's three of them. There's three men in front of me, and I'm sizing them up because I'm fresh out of prison. I got me some muscles. It's three of them. It's one of me, and I think that's a pretty fair fight because I'm a tough guy fresh out of prison. Little did I know that that would be one of the most traumatic moments in my life. So I'm standing in front of them, and they asked me the most deadliest question on earth, and I'm sure some of you know that. Does anybody know that? Who said that? He said, where are you from? Now, for those of you who don't know what he's talking about, he wasn't asking me, was I from Memphis? Did I used to live in Mississippi? Am I from another country? He wasn't trying to determine who I was in terms of a person, but as a gang member. Now, usually, if you're in a gang, you've already been conditioned. You've already been asked that question before in jail or somewhere else on the streets, you know, or you probably have asked someone else that question, but you know what goes along with that. There's a good probability that you're getting ready to have a fight. You're probably going to get shot, or you need to run real fast. Now, running wasn't on my list. I had a reputation. I had a social reputation, a social identity. I wasn't Ben Owens III. I was Taco, and I couldn't let these so-called enemies go back and say, yeah, Taco ran from us. So even despite the fact that the consequences could mean that I was about to lose my life, I did the dumbest thing that I could, and I told them where I was from. And in hindsight, thinking that I told him where I was from, he probably would have shot me anyway, because he already knew who I was. So I told him who I was, and the expected happened. He whipped out a .357 Magnum like a gunslinger, pointed it at me, and fired. The first bullet hit me in my right arm, blew through my, I guess this is the humerus bone, shattered it, turned it into powder. The other bullet also hit me in the arm and lodged there, still there till today. The impact from the .357 Magnum knocked me off my feet. I was on the ground. I believe I heard six shots, and I still can't tell you to the day, only that it's the grace of God that him shooting me point blank only hit me twice, and I know he shot six times. I could still smell the sulfur. I smelled the sulfur. I don't know if you've ever been around fireworks, but it's the gunpowder. I could smell it in my mind's nose. In my mind's ear, I can hear their footsteps running off while I'm laying on the ground. And I'm laying there, and I still remember my friend running out the house and picking me up and helping me get to a car, and they're going to run me to the hospital. By the time I'm in the car, police are everywhere. They block us off, they don't let me out, and then my friends are trying to explain, hey, he's been shot. Make it to the hospital and kind of examine myself and say, hey, well, I'm okay. I'm okay. And I wasn't talking about that I'm okay physically. I was talking about I'm okay that I had accomplished something else on my to-do list. My to-do list was to get shot. That was an honor for me, and I scratched that off. And so I went on. I continued to be a part of the gang. I had all of my honors. I had my degrees. I was a professional gang member, and I was a father now of four children living in Orange County, commuting back and forth every day to my neighborhood. And so when I got there, I would, you know, encourage my friends. At this time, I had stopped drinking, stopped using drugs, and I encouraged them to do something productive with your life. Do something, you know, get off drugs and stay sober, whatever. And because I had been there and done that, and my mantra was experience can be the best teacher. It can. It just doesn't have to be your experience. And so today, I'm part of Southern California Ceasefire, and I get there as a result of the 1992 peace treaty movement that kind of evolved from the riots. And little known to people that in 1992, it was a peace treaty year, but it was recorded as the year with the most homicides in LA County, with 2,000 people being killed that year. Now this during a peace treaty cycle. And we don't know if it was, you know, how many were gang members or non-gang members. We haven't really collected enough of that data. But this was a time where we were seeking peace and wasn't getting it. Fast forward to 2005, I was called back again to that peace table, and we were engaging the communities, but not only just for gang violence, Crip on Crip, Crip on Blood, and Black on Black, officer-involved shootings, all that meant something, and we had to figure out a way how to stop that. So one of the things were that we collectively sat down at the table and said, well, what is it that everybody can bring to the table? And in doing that, we found that everybody had their own little concepts on how that should happen, and everything led from creating the grid zones, which is the gang reduction youth development for the city, where we did the training, and we do the training for other interventionists. There are 23 grid zones in the city of Los Angeles. Those grid zones are areas where you have service providers, outreach workers that go out and help people get the resources that they need to get off the gangs. We also do what's called a Safe and Sober Summer campaign. I know that's a mouthful, but let me wrap it up with this. Safe and Sober Summer campaign is something that we've been doing for the last 10 years. So what we do every Sunday in the summer months through July to September is that we go out to hot spots in the different communities, and we pass out cold bottled water. Now, for some people that sounds corny, but that's what we do. Let me tell you why. Because in the hood, it costs 85 cents for 16 ounces of malt liquor. It costs $1.25 for 16 ounces of bottled water. It is cheaper to buy malt liquor in the hood than it is to buy bottled water. We pass out bottled water in the hood to keep people hydrated, because 50% of violent offenders in the state of California commit their offenses while under the influence of alcohol or drugs. And the last reason why we do pass out water on a Sunday and hydrate the community and keep them sober is because for the past 11 years in Los Angeles County, Sunday is the most deadliest day of the week. More people are murdered in LA County on a Sunday than any other day of the week. While people are getting ready to go to the mosque, to the temple, to the church, somebody's getting the phone call that their loved one has been murdered. So let me conclude with this. I chose More Than 100 Days and 100 Nights as a title because that saying, that theme went out as a result of a young man. He was pretty popular on social media, had a lot of followers. He did a lot of different things, and he was murdered. and the persons that murdered him that they felt were responsible, or his followers, posted that for the next 100 days and 100 nights, there will be retaliation killings for his murder. Incidentally, the area where he was from, where he lived, where he grew up, in South LA, is called the Hundreds. So there was a gang connotation attached to that, but what people don't know is that he was killed in the middle of July. There had already been 300 homicides. There had already been more than 100 days and 100 nights. The 100 days and 100 nights theme never came to fruition. Thank you for your time.
Well, Mr. Owens, thank you very much for that poignant and powerful presentation. It just underscores for me the reality that even today, 2017, in large swaths of this city, you can't be, especially a young man, and walk out of your house and walk down the sidewalk, especially after dark, but not necessarily after dark, without wondering, you know, is this the day that somebody's going to come up to me and ask me, where are you from? Is this the day when I'm going to get shot simply by walking out of my house and walking down the sidewalk? And yes, we had a peak in the late 1980s, early 1990s, but this is still a reality today right here in Los Angeles. Let me introduce our next speaker. Dr. Rochelle Dicker is a founder and director of the Wraparound Project in San Francisco. This is a hospital-based violence prevention program that has been replicated in other trauma centers. The program focuses on solving the underlying causes of gun violence, and Dr. Dicker has made a huge impact in her patients' lives. We're excited to hear from Dr. Dicker about the impact of this hospital-based project on reducing urban violence. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Rochelle Dicker, trauma surgeon at UCSF. Thank you.
Good morning. I really appreciate that kind introduction, and I want to tell you how much of a privilege it is to be here. As Dr. Prothrostith knows, she is one of my main inspirations for this work. While she was doing really serious stuff, I was at Chatsworth High School listening to Madonna and George Michael. But I've grown out of that phase, and I hope in some way I'm making you proud. Why do I do this kind of work? Why not just be a trauma surgeon? That's time consuming. I do it because of the potential of each of my patients being Mr. Ben Owens, really. And that continues to inspire me on a daily basis, really. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that last edge of what Dr. Prothrostith discussed as far as our really mantra in the world of public health after the fact. So I think about a scope of practice differently, and this is a little bit of a shift. We'll go back to the bedside. You know, you have a focus on an individual's acute needs, right? Especially if you're in such an intense environment as a trauma bay or an operating room. But then after that, you have to concentrate on the broader context. What is it that got people to this point, to your operating room, to your cardiology suite? What are those things? And what is the broader context of that? Ask the bigger questions, that's the key. And applying those principles of public health and chronic disease, yes, gun violence, stab wounds, this is a chronic disease, it's intergenerational. And some of those principles really allow you to get your arms around the issue when you're dealing with after the fact. Now, I have a young man who I'm quite proud of at this point. I'll talk to you about him at the end of this as well. But his name's Malik. He gave me the permission to use his name. 3 years ago, Malik was shot 5 times. And I'll never forget when he arrested in the trauma bay, somebody in the background saying, another one. And we opened his chest, got him back, took him up to the operating room. And the next thing I remember hearing besides the audible bleeding that occurs in my field, is the anesthesiologist saying, Rochelle, I have about three more units, and that's it. Three more units of blood. And it's a scary, really horrifying thing to hear. And I'll tell you more about Malik later, because he went through 14 operations, and he's in San Francisco right now. So you want to also observe the patterns with an eye of the population in need, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Surgery, by definition, people think is a curative type of a thing focused on an individual, implies high tech, high skills, and it's not cost effective. And then sort of the antithesis, if you will, in the traditional thinking is public health, that there's a prevention approach, focuses on populations, it's low tech, variable skills, it's more cost effective, and there's equity associated with it. Well, I think you know from our first speakers here that these are not mutually exclusive things. In fact, they are a great marriage. So what do you need to do to prove that? Well, the one thing, the one statement is just upfront to say that injury itself is a public health issue because it takes about 6 million lives worldwide every year. It kills more people than TB, malaria, and HIV combined. And so with that, then you start digging into more of the surveillance picture. But it is subject to all these really important components of public health. So we talk then in terms of, as you've heard, the severity and disparity of homicide in our youth and young adults. We know already it's the number one cause of death in young African Americans. You've heard that, and it's number two in Latinos. And we also know that it's oftentimes an urban story, but if you go to Oxnard, if you go to Salinas, some of these smaller communities, it's not only an urban story, and we need to modify some of our approaches as a result of our migrant population that's very vulnerable to this. But in San Francisco, it is an urban story. And then you get into, as I mentioned earlier, and Dr. Prothros just talked about, this idea of violence as being a public health issue that happened back in the 80s. And this sat on my desk as kind of a Bible for many years as we were formulating this idea, really, of a hospital-based violence intervention program. So then you have to start doing your homework, start somewhere, and really in a lot of ways, injury surveillance is a cornerstone to starting out. You need to know who your target population is, right? So we did our own within our own local community. We did our own surveillance with the Department of Public Health, great, great partner in a lot of cities, including here. And we found that 76% of homicide and assault victims had criminal histories. African American men were 13 times more likely to be injured, and 2 per 1,000 African American men were injured from violence. 4% of the population in San Francisco is African American. They make up 60% of our gun violence victims. Talk about a disparity. And now you know who to target. Now you know where the work is. And then again, as you've heard, you have to identify risk and protective factors as you're continuing. This isn't necessarily all about a stepwise fashion. You have to go back to point A all the time and look at yourself in a very critical eye and say, am I hitting the target population? Is this still the same data that I need as far as who is at risk? But while you're doing that, you identify risk and protective factors. And it is so critical, and here's where I've learned from my brothers and sisters in some of the chronic disease medical disciplines, that the social determinants of health are absolutely critical if we're going to address broadly gun violence and other forms of violence. It is a complex interplay of social and economic systems. And what does this mean for prevention? Well, what it means is that the idea of sewing somebody up and sending them out is not appropriate. That's the bottom line of what it means, that unless we really start to address the social determinants, we are going to see people back, and we know that. So here are some of the social determinants and the interplay. The good news is that those of us who are in this room, I think you show that promise by just being here. You know that we can make a difference with programs and policies to start to influence the social determinants of health. And here are some of them. We can call them risk factors, but as I've learned from a lot of my colleagues, there is that interplay. Social determinants, risk factors are really very critical. And I just want to mention this down here that I've learned a lot from my patients, my clients in the wraparound project, that this notion of normalization that is a part of what's happening in our vulnerable neighborhoods is really a driver. It's not until they meet somebody like Ben Owens that they realize, actually, you know what? This is not appropriate. This is not okay. And even though the media is not reporting on each of these events, it is not the way we should assume life just is in our country. It's never normal to be shot. So some of the protective factors that we focus on are adult mentorship, interpersonal skills, a commitment to school, access to resources. It's interesting, back in the 90s, a study was done and published in Science about the social cohesion and willingness to intervene for common good leads to a reduction in violence. And this is where things like Cure Violence, our brothers and sisters who work on a primary level in primary prevention come into play. But we also can understand that, because when you start to turn somebody around from a tertiary prevention perspective, they become really the saints of primary prevention, right? And it's based on this idea of building social capital. So then prevention and control and services. How do you start? Where do you start? Well, we do know that some prevention approaches don't seem to work. So things like scared safe, this notion of showing people their own video of when they came through the trauma bay and went through the whole airway breathing circulation, people don't need to see that. And in fact, it's probably not a good idea. In the spirit of trauma-informed care, this idea of re-traumatization is not really an approach that seems to work. So what is our role in the trauma center? Not showing people their videos, but in fact, the trauma center is an opportunity. It's a portal. It gives us a moment in time, that aha moment, that teachable moment that we've learned from other disciplines in medicine. So you take somebody who's had a cardiac event, for example, and you put them on an approach for diet, exercise, getting their sugars under control for diabetes. They have that moment where they're engaged, and they have that moment where you're there to provide them with an outlet. So those two things are really key, and we seize that opportunity. So we use the public health model. We have 5 case managers in our program. All have been part of the scene of urban violence in the Bay Area. And they are absolutely, on a regular basis, inspirations, and they're truly my heroes. We have community and city partnerships. Again, it's not just about tertiary prevention, but we have partnerships in the city. We cannot exist in a vacuum, where we can provide risk reduction services and reintegrate people into the community to then practice primary prevention, frankly. So developing and testing strategies, as I mentioned in the beginning, it's really important that you take a look at yourself again. Am I actually getting to the target population? Is it an appropriate approach that I'm using? Are my case managers effective? And you have to continue to evaluate the situation. So I'll give you the cornerstones. As I mentioned earlier, we use the public health approach. We seize that teachable moment when somebody is physically stable from their injuries to approach them at the bedside. We used to take no for an answer the first time. We don't do that anymore. We go back to the bedside, and maybe a different set of friends or a different set of family members will be in the room, or we'll slip somebody a card and they'll call later, but we now know that it may take 2 or 3 times. And we provide long-term culturally competent case management, and I'll get into that a little bit more. Really importantly, we provide links. So we are about that individual, because as a trauma surgeon, it just seemed natural to me. I'm standing at the bottom of the waterfall. I'm going to focus on this person. But we know that they're part of the broader community and that these relationships are extremely important. So what do we want to do ultimately? And we're starting to get there. We really want to provide an intervention to reduce recidivism and reincarceration, but we also want to change the standard of care in trauma centers so that we all have an opportunity to affect change. We're getting there. So I think the most critical piece of our programs really is this idea of the case managers, and I'll go into how many programs there are in the country now. They have a working knowledge of urban violence. They have experience overcoming violence. They're incredible at crisis management, and they're an amazing force in their communities. This is a lot, but it's important for you to see it as a lot. You have to understand what goes into building a violence prevention program in your hospital. I have had, for example, if you just look at organizational climate for a moment, I tried to reach out to another hospital to do a wraparound style hospital-based violence intervention program, and I talked to the CEO of the hospital, and no kidding, she said, why would I want to do this? Trauma is my cash cow. So understanding your climate is important, and also understanding how to speak the language of particular stakeholders in this so that you're armed with the kind of material and you're armed with the kind of approach that's necessary to make it happen. It's really important also that the community is not only involved, but that they own it. So the communities surrounding San Francisco that are most affected, those communities chose the first case manager, and subsequently we've had panels. I've never chosen any of the case managers. It's not coming from me. And so on a practical level, this is what the wraparound project and many programs in the country, frankly, look like. Somebody is injured and they go through their initial trauma care. During this time, the case managers, they wear the same pager I do. So they know something has occurred. We have a crisis management team in the city of San Francisco. So if we don't work 24/7 yet, but if we're not there, the crisis management team, and I see them at 2 a.m., they start to engage family. They go out in the parking lot, start to engage the people who have gathered there. I haven't figured out a way to measure the lack of retaliation in those situations, but I am sure that it occurs. The case managers go through trying to understand, really, in that moment, risk. There are low-risk individuals, there are high-risk individuals, and we enroll them in the wraparound project. Now, about 14% of people say no, and they stay that way, and our recidivism rate in those individuals is extraordinarily high. And so there is absolute room for improvement, as has been mentioned, absolutely. We, as I mentioned, don't exist in a vacuum. We are absolutely dependent upon our amazing partners in the community. A couple of our case managers have come from some of these community-based organizations. One of them actually works two jobs, and one of them is another one of these community-based organizations. The Trauma Recovery Center, as a surgeon, it took me a while to get it, but now I know that if you don't provide upfront mental health services to our population that's been violently injured, then these other risk reductions don't necessarily work upfront. People have to be ready for a job. They have to be ready to sit in a classroom, and you can't do that until you address some of these mental health issues that are quite entrenched oftentimes. And so this is just a little of an example of what we provide in-house. We have a what we call an advocacy center. And the really great thing about this is that people have the opportunity to get involved in a program to go to San Francisco State. They have opportunities to develop their resumes. These are all in-house places, and they're safe. It's a safe haven. It's a sanctuary, if you will. And we provide support groups in that. But again, integration and the fabric of the real program is not just based on the wraparound project, but it really, we exist as a cog in the wheel of the overall program that the city of San Francisco has. And then it's really important for evaluation, and I'm looking forward to the keynote speaker. We have a lot of room for improvement. How exactly to measure these programs has been in and of itself difficult, because it's not just about the individual that goes to my operating room, because there are societal factors that I can't go out and influence right off the bat, right? And so we have to take that into consideration. Where we used to want to just measure recidivism, we've gotten a little bit more complex in understanding that that's not what it's all about. We right now have a system of care that our case managers developed with a software company where we look at what people's needs are and whether they've been identified, whether we have actually been able to solve their need. What we've built into the system as of 2 weeks ago, and this is a database now at 6 different hospitals, is the understanding that people will get jobs and then they may not leave, they may not keep them. And so that dynamic is really important for us to understand and improve upon as well. Same thing goes for school, and same thing goes for vocational training programs. So the components of a program evaluation: formative, are you actually getting to your target population? Process, impact, outcome. These are all stages of quantitative evaluation. But as I mentioned earlier, we now have really an appreciation for just how complex this is. And measuring the value of these programs is really critical, and we don't have all the answers yet, honestly. We looked at independent predictors of success, and what we called success is somebody staying in the program, somebody being able to get to risk reduction resources based on the focus of our case manager's mentorship plan, and also lack of recidivism. And what we found up front was that what was most critical was providing mental health services and providing viable jobs for people. So that was, in an odds ratio sort of a form, what we found most critical. I'm going to talk a little bit about housing later, a sort of surprise to us. Education also was incredibly important, but not as much in our initial study, and this was about 6 years of running wraparound. Vocational training, and court advocacy also up there. At first, we were failing miserably with getting people jobs because a lot of the jobs require a driver's license, and so we had to step back and realize actually you need a driver's license before actually trying to get these jobs. So we've learned a lot. What we know is really important to all these programs is intensive case management, and one of my case managers loves to call it a dose. So he talks about it in terms of the first 3 months of people coming through wraparound, how much time do they spend with the case manager. And it looks like that intensive time really is related to success of the program. So Mike Texada, my senior case manager, has been with me for 11 years, and he said, I gotta give him a bigger dose. It's just, you know. So he'll go to the house and do a dose. So as I mentioned, mental health care and employment opportunities were predictive of success early on, and that value of early high-dose intensive case management appears to be essential. Now, this slide is just to show you a little bit of our advocacy center. This was a mural that was done by a bunch of our clients. But what this really I want to focus on is that this is a tertiary prevention program. However, our clients, one of whom is over there, becomes very ingrained in the primary prevention efforts. It takes a village, and here's a little piece of our village. When I looked at this picture, I couldn't believe. Here's a vocational training program, Friends of the Urban Forest. This is a leader of one of our community-based organizations. This is the COO of the hospital. Marcy works for juvenile justice. Ayerto works for Project Rebound at San Francisco State. You get it. It is a village. This was our celebration of our 10-year anniversary. And again, it's our 10-year anniversary. It's the community. It is all the people who come together as part of the fabric of violence prevention in San Francisco. And so then we looked at our decade, and it wasn't all good news, and you can see it in the December Journal of Trauma manuscript. So we had, over 10 years, we had 466 clients enrolled. Our recidivism rate was good. It was 50% less than historical controls. We didn't randomize when we first started this because there wasn't equipoise. A community member came to me and said, why didn't my son get wraparound services? San Francisco is very small, but also our institutional review board at UCSF said, you can't do this. There's no harm, and in fact, you can't randomize. And so I was pretty happy to hear that, actually. So we found in this subsequent study that was just published that meeting education needs was associated with success, and again, mental health services were critical. What we found, and I have in my mind a client who this just happened to, so he was at one of our vocational training programs, Friends of the Urban Forest. He was coming back from work and he was shot again outside of his house. He had stable housing. That was his place. And that's why it was kind of this moment of, it's not just about the individual, and we can't just measure recidivism off the bat. This is an amazing individual. In fact, he comes and talks to medical students with me in San Francisco all the time. And he is determined and is working 40-hour, 50-hour weeks. He's teaching middle schoolers at Friends of the Urban Forest right now. Quite extraordinary. But he was reinjured. He's a recidivist victim. So we have to take those things into consideration when we look at how to actually evaluate these programs. So the cost, that's another way to evaluate our programs. And we know that the cost of violence is well beyond the upfront medical bills. And so we also looked at cost-effectiveness analysis. We used a health economist method, a Markov analysis. And in short, what we actually found was that if you have any kind of burden of violent injury above about 4%, 5% of your overall trauma in your hospital, it's cost effective to have a violence prevention program. And I can lead you to where we demonstrated that if you would like more information. So I know I'm short on time. I want to talk a little bit about who funds this. We know up front, like in San Francisco right now, the mayor, starting with Gavin Newsom and now Ed Lee, they have been very supportive of this, again, in a larger context of the violence prevention efforts in the city. So we have a line item, and we're funded about 70% by that line item in the mayor's budget for our 5 case managers. We have total partners in the Department of Public Health who go to the mat for us for funding every year. And this, I just speak of wraparound, but it's a bigger thing in the nation. We know that foundations, federal governments, our partners out there are seeing all these funding streams coming through. And so I want to end with this idea of policy advocacy, which is part of this public health approach, right? So we now have a national network of hospital-based violence intervention programs. There are over 30 programs. 6 of us started this network about 8 years ago, and we provide curriculum development. We provide working groups that look at opportunities for example, development of a taxonomy. Healthcare workers or the case managers are now considered healthcare workers. There's a bill in California that is now on hold, but we're looking for ways to be able to fund violence prevention on a more sustainable manner in our hospitals. And we also share an annual conference with Cure Violence. It will be in Milwaukee in the summer. And we're constantly working through our group's research policy for ways to improve upon what we have now as a model in the country. The second piece of good news is the American College of Surgeons Committee on Trauma that sets criteria for trauma centers is looking at this as something that would be a criteria deficiency if you didn't have it in your trauma centers. So there is a subcommittee right now at this moment that is working on a best practices guide. There is a research agenda that's being developed, and the excitement of potential change in the criteria of trauma centers is a 20-year moment for those of us who have been doing this for a long time. So we're very excited about this. We have consultants from the front lines helping us with this. So in terms of future directions, we have a multi-institutional database that I mentioned quickly. We have over 4,000 clients to really understand across the country what we're looking at in terms of our population we need to serve. And we want policy to incorporate trauma-informed care. That's happening at a federal level right now. We're developing screening criteria and looking at a way of validating screening criteria instead of just what I call the case manager mojo. They know when somebody's high risk. So we're trying to get that on paper for fledgling programs. And as I mentioned, trying to demonstrate beyond recidivism the value of these programs. So why physicians? Why healthcare providers? Well, this is Malik. He came to see me actually, ironically, last week. And Malik is at San Francisco State learning to be a social worker. So that's why. It makes sense, and it's not just about stitching someone up. But we can elevate people. And unless we do it in this country and pay attention to our vulnerable populations, we will be going down by 2050, and the data is really there to support it on even CDC websites. We need to protect and we need to serve our entire population and pay attention to violence as a chronic disease. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Dicker. At this time, we're going to go to a 5-minute break. Bathrooms are out the back doors and to the left. There's still coffee and tea available outside where breakfast was. And this is just a reminder to drop off any raffle tickets because we're going to be collecting the jars at the end of the break. Thank you.
Okay, well, let's go ahead and get started for our post-break session. We're now heading into our keynote address, and that'll be followed by a panel discussion. And we're looking forward to hearing questions from the audience during the panel discussion. But at this point, I'm happy to introduce our keynote speaker. And we're honored today to have Dr. Howard Spivak deliver our keynote address. Throughout his career, he's been in leadership in various organizations at the community, state, and federal levels that focus on violence prevention. He is currently Deputy Director and Chief of the National Institute of Justice, the NIJ, and was formerly the Director of Violence Prevention at the CDC's Injury Center. We look forward to hearing his insight on the current status of gun violence in America, and what we as community members, students, and healthcare professionals can do to be advocates and play our part in the movement for social justice. Dr. Spivak.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. You know, it's gotten softer with each person. We need to perk things up a little bit. Can I close this, or does it have to stay open? So, on noon on Friday, January 20th of this year, there were some pretty high-profile changes that occurred in this country that I'm not going to get into, but one of the lower-profile events at noon on that day was that I became acting director of the National Institute of Justice. No. Now, that came with some consequences, one of which is I can no longer publicly speak without approved talking points, which is a huge problem for two reasons. One is, for people who know me, I never use slides, and I hate having talking points. I much prefer getting up and talking. The other is that when Deborah and I are in the same program, we've kind of grown up with this issue together, and so we think about it very similarly. So while I'm up here, I'm going to be doing some silent multitasking as I try to figure out how to fit what I want to say into my approved talking points without being redundant with what Deborah said. And I'd like to start with a couple of stories. And you've heard a number of stories today, but when one works in government, especially in Washington, D.C., and you talk about firearm violence, it's a very polarized, politicized issue. And you really often lose the sense that there's a real face to this issue. And it actually isn't a face, it's many faces. So I want to share a couple of stories with you, which I think reflect the spectrum of faces that I've experienced over the decades that I've been working in this area. I'd like to start with a story when I was working at Tufts Medical School. And I got back to my office from a meeting and found a huge stack of telephone messages. And that always only meant one thing, that there had been a school shooting. And that's how I knew there were school shootings. It wasn't from listening to the news or watching television. It was the size of the stack of telephone messages I got. And on this day, it had been a shooting in a place called Jonesboro, Arkansas. Most of these messages were from various news folks, but one of these messages was from a pediatrician in Jonesboro, Arkansas, inviting me to come down to Jonesboro. Now, this happened long enough ago that there's a lot of young faces here who probably have no idea what happened in Jonesboro, Arkansas, so let me just quickly recount it. Two young boys, one 10 and one 11, got up one morning and instead of going to school, went to one of their grandfather's firearm storage cabinets, broke into it, took out a number of firearms, went to their elementary school, set off the fire alarm, sat in ambush behind some bushes, and when the students started leaving the school, shot four students and a teacher. The four students were all girls, the teacher was a woman. Pediatrician who called me wanted me to come because even though it was after the fact, they were hoping to learn something from this and do something. And it was rather an odd experience for me because Jonesboro, Arkansas was not the typical place I got invited to by any means. It's a predominantly white, small city in Arkansas. I got there and found myself the first evening I was there at dinner at this fancy country club. In the middle of Jonesboro, and I'm sitting next to this guy who I just met, who in the middle of our small talk started sobbing. And what he said to me was, 18 months ago, I moved my family from Los Angeles to Jonesboro because I wanted to raise my kids in some place that was safe. And Los Angeles was too violent for me to raise my children. So I came to Jonesboro, and look what happened. And what was most meaningful about this is that this man was a pediatrician in a practice of six pediatricians that had actually taken care of two of the girls who had been killed and one of the shooters. And among other things, they knew that this shooter came from a family with intimate partner violence going on. And he was partly sobbing because he realized that you can't escape this issue, and he was partly sobbing because he felt like they somehow had some responsibility for this because they hadn't dealt with the issue. So that's one face in this. Second face was when I worked at the Department of Public Health when Deborah was commissioner and I was deputy commissioner. And a good friend of mine was doing a documentary on youth violence prevention. And I sat in on an interview where she was interviewing the 17-year-old junior in high school who was a peer counselor in one of the city's outreach programs. And I'm listening to this interview and this girl starts rattling off all the people she knew who had died and all of the funerals she had been to. And it turned out this 17-year-old girl had in her 17 years of life been to 16 funerals. And these were not funerals of grandparents or parents or old people or even adults. These were all children. a brother, a cousin, a neighbor, classmates. And it was devastating to listen to her tell this story, although it was also, in an odd way, uplifting, because she had become a peer counselor because of these experiences, and she felt like she needed to do something about this and not simply be devastated by the whole thing. Okay, the third story is listening to a young woman at a conference of sibling, a meeting of sibling survivors that actually Deborah and some of her colleagues at the Harvard School of Public Health had set up. And one of the people who spoke there was the sister of a student who had been shot and killed in Columbine High School in Littleton, Colorado. Now, this also happened a long time ago, but I'm assuming most of you probably know about that, where it was at that point the largest school shooting that had occurred in this country. And this young woman said something that just floored me, because it was such a powerful statement and it said so much. And what she said was, in an instant, I became a citizen of a foreign country I'd never heard of and learned a foreign language that I never knew existed, in an instant. And it made me realize how dramatically and permanently these events can affect people. And here I am, I'm a pediatrician in Boston in an inner city practice. And I'm listening to her, coming from a relatively affluent, suburban, white community, and beginning to realize that every kid I was seeing was experiencing what this girl was talking about every day, which gets to my last story, which is a family that I knew quite well, an 8-year-old girl who I'd known since birth, whose mother had another child, a son, and this girl came in with her mother at the infant's, her brother's two-week visit, and she was dressed up in her Sunday clothes, because she always dressed up when she came to see me. And I said, so what's it like being a big sister? And she said, well, I'm very happy and I'm very sad. And I said, what do you mean? And she said, well, I'm very happy because I'm so happy to be a big sister, and I'm very sad because I'm scared for my brother. And she said something to me that I'd never known in the 8 years I'd known her, which is that in her 8 years of life, she had never slept in her bed. She had slept under her bed. She lived in a community called Mattapan, outside of Mattapan Square, where there were shootings nightly, or at least gunshots going off nightly. And on occasion, these bullets would come through walls and through windows. And she only felt safe sleeping under her bed. And now she had a little brother. And she was petrified for him. And that was, again, flabbergasting to me. And I have many of these stories, but I think about them a lot, and I think it's important for all of us to keep thinking about these stories, because if we lose the sense of the face of this problem and we get lost simply in the politics of the debate, then we lose the humanity of this issue, and that's extremely important. So now I'm going to talk about science and gun violence prevention. And the name of this talk is rather frustrating to me, because it's Preventing Gun Violence, the Need for Good Science. Quite frankly, I'd much rather be giving a talk on the good science of gun violence prevention. The problem is that there's very little good science, and that's a huge problem. And I do want to talk about that, and I'm going to get back to that. But to have a title of a talk of that is a very powerful statement in a lot of ways, and a very frustrating one, especially having worked around this issue for so many years. So what do we know about gun violence? There are well over 300 million guns in circulation in this country, probably closer to 400 million guns, more guns than people. And we don't even know how many guns there are, because the agency that's supposed to monitor this, which is called Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, which is in the Justice Department, is not allowed to computerize or create electronic records of all of the gun registrations that they have. So all of their records are on microfiche, sitting in boxes in storerooms. And when they have to go to do a trace on a gun, they literally have to go to these boxes and pull up the microfiche and put it on a machine and scroll down to collect the information. Because there is a fear in this country that if this gets into an electronic format, that there will be a gun registry in this country and we will know who owns guns and we're going to go take them away from everybody. But this, the number of guns also is a very important consideration in this, because quite frankly, if there's 400 million guns out there, this idea that we can somehow limit access to guns is just not a viable solution to this. Somehow we have to approach this problem and this issue in a very different way. These guns are not going to go away. They do not break, or they rarely break. They last a really long time. And a lot of the solutions we have are going to have to come to peace with the fact that these things are out there and they're not going to go away. So we also know that having a firearm in the home dramatically increases the risk of a family homicide, a family suicide, or an unintentional firearm-related death. Now, this is sentinel work that was done decades ago by an emergency room physician named Art Kellerman. And as powerful as this work is, this is the research that led to the legislation and the language in the federal budget that has led to preventing the Centers for Disease Control to do firearm research. This was labeled junk science. And the CDC funded this work, and Mark Rosenberg, who we all love dearly, used the results from this research to get up on a soapbox and start preaching gun control. And Art told me, he begged Mark not to do that. And Mark did it, and it almost shut down the entire injury center at the CDC. Okay, so we also know that geographic areas with higher levels of gun ownership have higher rates of gun-related injuries and deaths. That's a no-brainer. That's not rocket science. It's obvious, but there's good data that shows that in communities with higher numbers of guns, more people die by guns. We also know that countries with fewer firearms have fewer firearm-related deaths. Deborah talked about that, but there's a sentinel study that was done by Fred Rivera a number of years ago comparing Seattle and Vancouver, where his statistical analysis basically showed that the difference in deaths between those two cities was directly related to the rates of gun ownerships in those cities. Canada, people don't have guns. The United States, people have a lot of guns. And they looked at multiple factors, and the only thing that held consistently true in their analysis was the rates of firearm ownership between those two cities. Now, there's also some important things that we don't know. And probably the most important thing is that we have no idea whether any of the strategies being suggested that limit or restrict access to firearms actually make a difference. So we have this huge conversation in this country about what we're calling common sense firearm strategies, but there's no science to support them. And one of my fears is we're going to try to get some of this passed and we're not going to see a huge change because there's so many guns out there and there's so many ways of accessing guns. And most, especially young people, they don't go to stores and buy guns. They're guns that are coming through the black market in various ways. And so the legal restrictions are going to have little to no impact is most likely, but we don't even have science to tell us if that's true or not. Now, this has been said over and over this morning, but I'm going to say it again, and that's gunfire from assaults and suicides and unintentional shootings have an enormous human burden in this country. But I want to give another dimension to this. One of the things that I've experienced since I've come to the Department of Justice is I hang out a lot with cops, which I never did before. And what I've learned through ride-alongs and a variety of other things, that most of these folks are good people who want to do good things and are burdened with the experiences that people have with the bad cops that are so dramatically blown up, as they should be, that it creates an overlay on all of them, that creates huge issues for them. And in fact, one of the phenomena we're starting to see in this country is that cops are arresting fewer and fewer people. And part of this may be because crime rates are falling, but part of it is because cops are having second thoughts about arresting people and getting into confrontations with people. They lose their jobs. They lose their benefits. There's huge risk for them when they do this. And even if they're not punished, even if it's shown that there was a legitimate reasoning behind their behavior, it never plays out that way at this point. So on the one hand, we've got to think about the trauma this is doing to individuals and communities, but we've also got to better understand the dynamics of police officers in this environment as well, because it's a equilateral equation. It's going in both directions. And they're being as victimized, well, I'm not sure if they're being as victimized, but they're certainly being victimized by this situation in very powerful ways that have significant impact. I also want to say that we do know that the impact of gun violence has a disproportionate effect on certain populations, certain vulnerable populations, young people, people living in poverty, communities of color. And it's important to recognize that, but it's also important not to overstate that to the point where somehow people can continue to say, that's not my problem, that's their problem. It happens to those people in those communities, because that's what we experienced when we first got involved in youth violence prevention 30 years ago or 35 years ago. Oh, Deborah, here I go. I told you I'd stop counting. The policy then around violence was containment. As long as it stayed in the inner cities, and as long as it was kept there and didn't spill out, it was somehow acceptable and okay. And it wasn't until it started spilling out that it stopped being so okay. And the last thing you want to do is go back to the thinking where it's those people and those communities and it's not important to me, because that's underlying one of the issues around the lack of resources that we're experiencing to deal with this issue more effectively. Now, here's where I'm doing my multitasking, because I'm about to skip a couple of pages about public health, because it's already been done here. I will say one sort of general thing, and that there's not a single type of violence, of gun violence. There's a set of things. There's the urban street violence. There's intimate partner violence. There's mass shootings. There's suicides. There's unintentional gun injuries. Those have some similarities, but they're also very different as well. However, for me, the most important way to approach this is to approach it from the interpersonal violence perspective, because that's the context within which most of this firearm violence is occurring. Now, we need to pay as much attention to suicide by firearm as well. It's a somewhat different phenomenon, and there may actually be better and simpler strategies for dealing with suicide by firearm, because that may be the one real area where restricting access in some way may make a difference. Suicide's a very impulsive behavior. If you have a waiting period, the moment passes. That can make a huge difference. So there may actually be some effectiveness in this. I'm not sure it will be nearly as effective or potentially effective in the interpersonal violence that we see among people who know each other, in intimate partner violence situations. And there's a unique element in intimate partner violence that's important here, and that's that firearms not only have the potential of killing people, but more often, firearms are used for intimidation and control. So even if they're never used, the firearm is still playing a devastating role in that relationship that, and in that dynamic. That is one of the reasons that sometimes women are afraid to leave, because they fear that they're going to be, that their partner's going to come after them with a gun and kill them. So I want to focus on the interpersonal violence. One of the best examples of the fact that we don't know nearly enough was illustrated well in the January 2016 issue of the Journal of Epidemiological Reviews that was totally dedicated as an edition that focused on firearm violence, risk, consequences, and prevention. This is an excellent collection of systematic reviews of some of the science that's been done by some of the top public health and firearm researchers in the country. The overall conclusion from this issue was that the available science in this area is far too limited to answer most of the important questions necessary for mounting a successful effort to reduce gun violence. And that if we want to put ourselves in the position to make unbiased assessments and evaluations of policies and programs, we must significantly invest more in the research that's around this. Although I will say, one note of exception in this issue was that there's one article in there that actually contradicts the statement that I made, that we don't know anything about the effects of these policies around access, because in fact, there is good evidence to show that restricting access for individuals who have restraining orders in situations of intimate partner violence results in less intimate partner violence. So that's at least one situation where that may be positive. It's our one point of encouragement about potential policy solutions here. So let's talk about investing in science. There's a researcher at Mount Sinai Hospital who recently published an article, I think it was in the Journal of American Medical Association, that where he did a statistical model analysis of the investment in science around the top 30 causes of death in this country. And based on his analysis of people dying from gunshots, where there were about 350,000 deaths over the 10-year period that he analyzed from 2004 to 2014, his formula predicted that there would be nearly $1.5 billion in gun violence research funding from the federal government. That's billion with a B. And over 40,000 scientific publications resulting from this investment. Well, the reality is that over that same 10-year period, there was $22 million invested in firearm research. That's million with an M. And fewer than 2,000 scientific articles related to firearms and firearm violence. So, in short, we're spending about 1.5% of what we probably ought to be spending in research on firearm violence, and we're publishing less than 5% of the scientific articles that we should be producing around this issue if we were treating this like any other primary cause of death in this country. Now, I'm almost embarrassed to say this, but I say it because it's a point of pride in working at the National Institute of Justice. NIJ is, in fact, the only federal agency that has been consistently funding firearm research in this country. So most of the $22 million that's been spent in this research has come out of NIJ. Not very much, but on top of that, NIJ for the last 6 years has been putting out an annual solicit request for proposals for firearm research and has invested in things such as data-driven strategies to reduce gang and drug-related violence, study of illegal firearm markets, a huge issue, especially for access to firearms for young people, evaluation of prevention and intervention programs, including an evaluation of cure violence, and is currently funding studies looking at the impact of state-level firearm laws, as well as specifically in California, an analysis of the shootings by law enforcement and correction officers and an evaluation of California's armed and prohibited person system. I think what's also important, and this is really new for the Justice Department, is for the first time, NIJ's put out a solicitation this year on the prevention of community violence. Now, that doesn't sound like a big deal for people in public health, because that's been going on for a long time. But in justice, it's a huge deal, The justice system is a reactive system. It's not a proactive system. So for justice dollars to be going into prevention is a huge shift, and hopefully one that will continue. Now, as proud as I am about NIJ's commitment to this, it's grossly inadequate. And we can't count on a single federal agency funding this. This has to be coming from multiple points of funding, and not just public dollars, but private dollars as well. And one of the sobering facts about the restrictions of funding for firearm research at the federal government is it's had somewhat of an overlay of anxiety on the part of private foundations to fund firearm research as well. So it's been kind of a double whammy there, where multiple sources of funding to better understand and advance the science of firearm research has been grossly restricted and inhibited. Now, that doesn't mean we don't know some things that can help us with this. We know that, for example, a large amount of the firearm violence in this country occurs in relatively small known locations, so we can target the work we do. The disproportionate amount of violence also occurs among a relatively small number of individuals. We also know that there is a contagious effect around violence. I'm not sure we completely understand it, and it worries me when we start equating it with an infectious disease, because I don't think it's as simple as that. But there is some kind of social contagiousness around violence that does occur, where it seems to be transmitted within groups and among groups. We also know that individuals exposed to trauma early in their lives are at much higher risk for involvement with violence, both as victims as well as perpetrators of violence. And the ACE study that was initially done by the CDC what's the name of the insurance company here? Well, yeah, anyway, is really excellent, because what we do know is that there are identifiable types of trauma that do set people up for high risk. And what's really interesting, and this gets to some of the sort of neurologic and biological science of violence, is that the risks for involvement in violence parallel the same risks these individuals have for higher rates of cancer and heart disease and stroke and diabetes. And there's a couple of reasons for this that are really important to understand. And here's another area of science that needs a lot of work. And that's the biological impact of these experiences. Because what we do know is that exposure to violence early in life actually changes the architecture of the brain. And the brain works differently as a result of this. And what we don't know is how reversible this is and how aggressive we need to be early on to try to reverse the effects of this architectural change. And more recently, and this is scary as hell, is that the research on chromosomes and genetics suggests that these early exposures to stress and violence have a direct effect on the body's chromosomes as well. And what it does is it speeds up the aging process. That individuals who've had these experiences, aging is essentially related to the shortening of chromosomes, the loss of genetic material at the ends of chromosomes. And what's been found is that children who have had these experiences have faster deterioration of the chromosome structures, which may, in fact, explain what some of the higher risk for chronic disease is all about here. So it's not simply that people who have been stressed smoke and drink a lot, but there's an actual biological change in their bodies that affects them and that creates their risk. And it creates their risk for involvement with violence, and it creates their risk for chronic disease. And these are not unrelated things. And that makes it all the more important for healthcare to be involved in this. Because if we're trying to deal with chronic disease and we don't deal with violence, then we're missing an important issue here. Sorry, I'm doing some multitasking here. So if we look at the localized nature of interpersonal violence, and I mention this with caution so that we don't over-stereotype neighborhoods in the process, half of deaths of gun violence occur in just 127 cities in this country. And it's not just in those cities, but it's in very specific definable neighborhoods in these cities. And these are neighborhoods marked by extreme poverty, low levels of education, and racial segregation. Now, what that implies to me is not to label these neighborhoods, but to recognize that if we're going to deal with the issue of violence and gun violence, that we have to start dealing with the social and economic environments that people are growing up in. And, you know, Deborah talked a lot about this issue of saving face and this culture of saving face that contributes to violence in these poor communities. And I think about it that way, but slightly differently, in that I think that, sadly, these kids are developing functional responses to dysfunctional environments. So how can we blame these kids for these behaviors when they're growing up in environments where if they don't do this, they don't survive? This is very real for them, and we can't simply say, don't do that, or without dealing with the circumstances around them. So the solutions here, and the investment in science not only needs to understand the dynamics of interpersonal violence, but it needs to understand how to better advance our understanding and making the case for investing in economic and social programs that work with and support these communities to change the environments these kids go into. You know, it's really interesting. There's a part of community, or well, it's called community policing. I'm not sure I call it that, which is the broken windows approach, which when I first heard about it, I said, oh, what a great idea. They're going to go into communities and they're going to fix up these boarded up buildings and clean up these empty lots. Terrific idea. You clean up the neighborhoods. When you live in an environment that looks better, you behave better. Very obvious. Well, that's not what broken windows is. The broken windows are people, not the environment. And so it's arresting and essentially assaulting people for making minor violations, like selling cigarettes illegally on a street corner. And it's treating them like they're the broken windows in the community, instead of treating the broken windows that create an environment that greatly affects how people behave. There's a really interesting study, actually, in Flint, Michigan, where they've done created community gardens in some of the empty lots, and they've cleaned these lots up and gotten rid of the needles and the garbage and all of that stuff, and created community gardens. And what they've discovered when they do this is that there's a ripple effect that goes about two blocks, where once you create a community garden, people start taking better care of their own property, and suddenly people start developing their own gardens. And you can literally look. You can walk down the street and see how the houses are getting fixed up and the yards are getting cleaned up. Great example of how your surroundings affect your behavior. How am I doing with time here? Okay, I'm not going to take 10 minutes at this point. Because I don't want to repeat the stuff that Deborah has done and what some of the other folks have done. I think we've heard some incredibly good presentations with respect to the public health approach to violence prevention. And I really think it's important for us to invest in that. And I think it's incredibly uplifting to be here and see this room filled with a lot of young people in medical school, in nursing school, in pharmacy school, who are invested in this issue, because you're the folks that are going to do this. Us old folks have done much of what we've done, and we need to pass the baton on to you. And the work you do needs to continue the work in public health, but it also needs to start transmitting the public health approach into other disciplines as well. And one of the arguments I've made in the Justice Department more and more is that by definition, public health is a multidisciplinary discipline. Well, criminal justice science is also a multidisciplinary area. And that if we leave the science of criminal justice up to the criminologists, we're not going to get any place. It's a shallow field. There aren't a lot of people there. They're very inbred, and they just restudy the same things over and over again. And we need to bring fresh ideas into this research. So we need folks like you, not simply to do your medical research, but you need to start looking at how you can contribute to the research that's going on in other disciplines, and especially criminal justice. And one of the things we've done at NIJ, and I hope this continues, is that we've done extensive outreach to the public health community and the sociology community and the anthropology community to get involved in criminal justice research. With fellowship programs and a variety of things, because most of the people in those disciplines don't think about criminal justice as an area of research. NIJ has a budget of $250 million, half of which is for forensic research. So only half of that $250 million is actually for anything meaningful to criminal justice programs themselves. And half of that is for school safety. So all of the science around policing and the correction system and prisons and community violence and all of that stuff has slightly over $50 million in research. Now compare that to the investment in research in the healthcare system, where NIH has, what, $30 billion? The CDC probably has another $10 or $15 billion. There's a huge disparity here that needs to be addressed. And for the healthcare community to stand up and say this is extremely powerful. This can't simply come out of the criminal justice system because it's too small and it's too embedded in responding to violence, not preventing violence. So I want to end with just one comment, and this really relates to a situation that Deborah talked a bit about in her presentation, which is our experience in Boston. It's not hard to feel incredibly overwhelmed by this issue. With all the guns out there, with all the violence that we experience in this country, with all the violence that we're seeing around the world, so it's not unique to this country, although the consequences are more serious because of the guns, it's easy to feel overwhelmed. But when you've lived in a community that went over 3 years without a juvenile homicide, without all the good science we still need, but with hundreds if not thousands of people stepping forward and lining up together and creating a real social movement and a social change in that city, resulting in no children being murdered for over 3 years, that means it can be done anyplace and needs to be done anyplace. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Spivak, for a really outstanding keynote presentation. And thank you all for being with us this morning. At this point, we are going to begin our panel question and answer session, so I'd ask all the speakers to come forward and join me on the podium here, on the stage here. And think about questions that you might want to ask at this point. We have one microphone available on the in the audience here, and think about what you want to ask, and you might want to start to queue up with your questions. First come, first served. And I'll say that a point about the questions, let's make sure that they're all questions, so think about, you know, Jeopardy style. And number two, let's limit the questions to 30 seconds so that we can get as many people up here as possible with their questions. So we have all the panelists, and we're ready to go. And I'll start with the first question, since there's nobody in the audience so far. You know, if you'd asked me as kind of a health policy wonk kind of person, what's the one thing we could do to take a big step to eliminate health disparities in the United States, my answer would be give everybody health insurance. I don't mean to be provocative in a timely sense right now. But let me ask the panelists, if there's one thing that you might recommend to target gun violence and to reduce it or eliminate it in the United States, what would be that one thing?
I would say the responsibility of the gun owner, we hear a lot about gun control, but I would like to say control your gun. A lot of times in the urban community, when we hear about gunshot victims, typically we would assume that the person shot was shot with a firearm that was illegally obtained. One in particular case was a young man. He was shot. He was killed. They recovered a firearm, and by the time they traced it back down to the owner, the gun had been missing for 2 years, and the owner never reported it stolen. So it's situations like that that when you have a firearm, an instrument of death in some cases, and you aren't in possession of it, or you don't know where it's at, and this could have the potential to take someone's life, then I think we need to come up with better, guidelines. And if you're a gun owner, that gun needs to be in your possession, or at least you need to know where it's at all times.
Thank you. Other responses? Dr. Perthostiff?
Well, I am a real primary prevention person. So if you gave me the magic wand, I would probably focus in on the public schools and wrap around the especially elementary schools, a set of services that would include a big brother, big sister for every kid in the school. There's some really robust data about the short-term impact of having a big brother, big sister, and the evaluation included a random assignment off of the waiting list, so that, again, one of the strongest evaluations of such programs. I would also make sure that every elementary school had what's called a universal violence prevention curriculum, which is for everybody, not for targeted bad students, but something that happens throughout the school. And then some of the ways to engage parents, some of the innovative ways, like doing English as a second language in school, or other sorts of classes that, and really, it's Dreyfus's work that that turns a school into a community center, basically, and doesn't close at 3 o'clock, and has a series of services for the full community. The police engagement in the school, I would not have them be officers in the school, but I would have police be educators like they were in the DARE program. And even though DARE didn't prove to be successful in reducing substance abuse, I think having our police officers see kids in a school setting doing what kids do and not in those troubled settings is another way to, you know, impact how they approach the children in certain neighborhoods. And also, I suspect it affects the way children approach the police. And then lastly, I think we have to have some way of teaching and helping people heal from the bad things that happen, because the bad things happen. And I like that framing of, you know, kids figuring out in a functional way how to deal with dysfunctional situations. And sometimes their ways are dysfunctional. You know, with your mother on drugs and your responsibility for siblings being that of what an adult would need or ordinarily be, I think we have to understand, have empathy for some situations that kids are responding to, and in those settings, teach them and help them with the skills of responding to bad things that happen to them, because many of them have some really exposure to violence is one of them, but, you know, exposure to racism, exposure to, you know, low opportunities, the community and the way it looks. But that would be my, I would go there.
Indeed. Dr. Spivak.
Yeah, I agree with everything Deborah said, and I actually want to emphasize one point a little further in what she said, which I think is huge, because we do know that there are particularly vulnerable individuals that are at much higher risk for involvement in violence. So I think dealing with trauma-informed care, identifying as early as possible individuals who have had these experiences, focusing on healing for those individuals, I think is particularly important in the context of a larger prevention initiative that gets to everybody. And I think we have to keep in mind, and this was really a powerful finding in the Kaiser Permanente work, was this is not a rare phenomenon here. In an affluent, white, middle, upper class community, the rates of experience with trauma early in one's life were extremely high. And so when you then look at these adverse childhood experiences in higher risk communities, and those numbers are through the roof, we have to remember that this is still, as is true with the issue of intimate partner violence, which crosses all socioeconomic and demographic groups, this exposure to trauma early in one's life and the risk that creates, it is woven through all communities as well. So that really has to be addressed in a more consistent way. I think the healthcare system is central in this because the healthcare system in some ways is the only public institution that exists in this country that gets to children early enough, I think, to deal with this stuff effectively. It's long before they get into school. It's long before any other institution gets access to these kids.
Dr. Dicker, did you have a comment also?
Just really quickly, echoing what's been already said, but it's interesting that oftentimes you'll see departments of public health that are strapped, that the first thing they cut, and this doesn't make sense from my perspective, is mental health care. And where do they end up? In my trauma bay, on my wards. When I was on service last week, 50% of my patient volume, and that's pedestrian injury, falls, violent injury, they had mental health diagnoses. And you may or may not believe in the diagnoses, but 50% of my 40 patients had a diagnosis. And it's expensive to take care of trauma patients. If we can provide fundamental mental health care, I think that we can avoid some of that in so many ways. So I just want to emphasize that.
Certainly, yes.
Yeah, I just want to add something quick to that because I think that's really important. We in this country dismantled our mental health institutions and our community mental health system at exactly the same time. And so what we've done is we've created hospital emergency rooms, and the police have become our mental health providers of last resort. That's created a crisis in this country that is overwhelming and, again, deeply rooted in all of what we've been talking about here today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for those responses. Let's take our first question from the audience.
Hi, my name is Angela Venegas. I am a pediatrician and I'm a scholar at UCLA through the National Clinician Scholars Program. And I'm proud to say that I'm doing research in this area. And I wanted to hear your opinions or experiences in expanding trauma-informed care, not only in the healthcare system, but training of doctors, training of I guess school personnel, administrators, and the criminal justice system, and how to adapt some of those techniques and curriculum.
Anyone?
I was a case manager at St. Francis Hospital, working with the trauma unit, dealing with a lot of victims. Most of them were shot out in the community. And we had a particular situation where a young man came in, he was shot directly in the middle of his forehead. They said that, they don't know if he attempted to commit suicide or if a friend shot him. They really couldn't put the pieces together, but he came in, had brain matter coming out the middle of his forehead. They took him to ICU for about 3 days, and the parents, they came, and they weren't together, but they came, and They would visit with him. The doctors, you know, eventually called him in the room and said, you know, there's no brain activity, and you know, gave him some other, you know, medical jargon that they really couldn't understand. And the mother, she's looking like, I don't understand what you're saying. So he just blurted out, called the morgue. And the mother just lost it, and she tried to attack the doctor, and the other rest of the family members tried to, you know, get her, because they felt they were just so insensitive that this doctor, who considered the individual being a patient, didn't take into account that this was this mother's son. So some of that training, that engagement, that sensitivity to be able to deal with the community, to deal with, you know, people's personal experience with trauma, and being able to communicate that to them. It didn't make matters better that this was an individual. He was shot in the head. He was obviously going to die, but they asked the family, did they want him to donate his organs? And when you're a victim at this particular hospital, the agencies that's acquiring the organs, they don't help pay the cost of the funeral or anything. So basically, they're harvesting or salvaging the organs, and the family gets back the body, and they're left to sell chicken dinners or whatever it is to do to make the burial arrangements. So again, it's extremely difficult if you don't have that translation piece between the doctor and those families that come through there.
And I'll jump in and say that St. Francis Medical Center that Mr. Owens just mentioned is located in Linwood, California. It's the registered trauma center closest to what is probably the concentrated area of gun violence in South Los Angeles, called the Vermont-Figueroa Corridor. It's a level 2 trauma center. The nearest level 1 trauma centers to that part of Los Angeles are California Hospital downtown and Harbor UCLA Medical Center in Torrance. St. Francis has to shoulder a major load of gun violence trauma for the county of Los Angeles. Other comments?
Well, I was going to say, and their head of trauma surgery, Dr. Chalker Shepherd, has been a huge part of the violence prevention coalition and activities here in Los Angeles. And then a comment on your question. We have a saying that it's hurt children who hurt themselves and other children. And being able to appreciate that pain, whether the child is sitting in the classroom or showing up for a pediatric visit or showing up for immunization, and really beginning to help. I mean, if we think about the hurt that we have had in our lives, and we've all had that hurt, sometimes there are rituals like funerals that help us process it and deal with it. Certainly, parents and family will help us know what sort of ritual or what sort of processing. But when you are absent, healing strategies, and you have just accumulated trauma, it can be institutional providers, whether it's teachers with a peace zone curriculum or physicians who are really responding to that need and including family and community. But that notion of having our care, having our service, having our activities be informed by the trauma that the people we're serving or working with or partnering with have experienced, I think is hugely important as a movement. It's different from labeling, and I think that's where, you know, it's a nuance at one level, but I think it's really important in a school or in a pediatrician's office to be able to offer strategies, but not label in a way that becomes kind of self-fulfilling prophecy.
Thank you. Other comments? Okay, thank you for your question. And again, if you have questions, please come forward to the microphone. We have some more time before the end of the panel discussion. Yes.
Hi, my name is Oladini Adeyiga. I'm an infectious diseases physician here at UCLA. I just want to thank all of you for your comments and the knowledge that you shared. My question is for you, Mr. Ben Owens. Thank you so much for sharing your story. At one point you said that among your siblings, you all grew up in the same environment, but you were the only one who joined a gang. And I just wondered, if you have some thoughts on why you believe you are different from your siblings from that perspective, and if they also have thoughts about that from their own shared experience with you. Thank you.
I think for the most part, my older brother, we didn't have the same father. My younger brother was actually the son of my stepfather. I felt isolated in a sense because my older brother, he didn't really care so much about having a relationship with his own biological father, but myself, I did, and my younger brother, I had already had a relationship with my stepfather. While I was in prison, I did peace efforts, and part of that included, you know, contacting other inmates and just having a discussion, and I did a survey, and it's probably close to about 2,000 people that took the survey. And what was astonishing that most of the people who took the survey, there was a questionnaire that asked them, were you the oldest, the youngest, or the middle? Most of them were the middle child. Most of my friends, gang members, are the middle child. And again, I don't understand the logic or how that makes any difference, but I really can't explain why they chose not to join a gang. And again, like I said, we were exposed to the same environments, but it was a choice that I made because I found a sense of power and strength in a gang. My older brother, he went to the Army, and that's where he found his sense of desire. My younger brother, he also went to the Army, but I was drawn to the gangs.
I'd like to make a comment on that in the context of really pushing, using this as another example of the importance of the need for more science here. I think these stories have a lot of richness to them. I think we need to use these stories as takeoff points to understand them and bring some science to this so that they're not simply stories of individuals, but we can begin to use what's under these stories and what explains these stories as a way of being much more proactive for people. So because we can change the trajectory of people if we understand what's going on and can intervene earlier. But we first have to understand better what is influencing that trajectory.
And this is a gripe I have with public health. I love public health. But ethnography and qualitative sciences have a lot to offer our more epidemiological and scientific approaches to things. We sometimes do the survey before we really know what questions we ought be asking, before we understand the nuances. So partnerships between public health professionals, health providers, and ethnographers, I think could potentially be very, very helpful to our understanding of this kind of very complicated problem.
Yeah, I'm now going to get myself into trouble, but not with the government, with scientists. We really have to look beyond our rigid connectedness to having to explain everything with random controlled trial studies. And there's a richness and quality to qualitative research that really can inform this work. We don't get all our answers from these rigid case-controlled studies. There's an integration of that rich science with the richness of the qualitative science. And that is an issue in public health. It's an issue in criminal justice research as well, that if there isn't an RCT, it's not real. And that's, I think, backed us into a terrible corner. And the reality is that some of the qualitative research is far less expensive to do, and yet is incredibly rich. And let me tell you, we have an advertising industry in this country, a multi-billion dollar industry, that functions on qualitative research and makes a lot of money from it. And I don't understand why our science community can't learn from that.
And that's why Mr. Owen's survey that you did, 2,000 responses, that's very impressive, is so informative, and that finding about the middle child, that's really interesting also. Our next question.
Hi there, my name is Matthew. I'm a family medicine resident at Harbor UCLA. And my question is that what are some ways that young professionals or young trainees like myself can kind of be involved in kind of advocating and for reduction of gun violence, knowing that kind of a limited and shallow dedication can sometimes cause more harm than good?
Very good question. I was about to ask that also.
I would love to start that one. Thank you for that question. And in fact, I think you're exactly right. What is oftentimes concerning is this notion, and family medicine does this, there is some permanence in the community and community-based organizations, but medical students and residents will go for a month, and that can be extremely disconcerting to people who are going to those community-based organizations, who oftentimes are really used to us letting them down and not having any sort of staying power. And so the approach really has to be on the sense of permanence and sustained relationships. And up front, you really have to say to people that you're only there for a short period of time. And the humility that you need to show up front is extraordinarily important. And so just the skimming surface. You're in a great position all along the spectrum from point A, primary prevention, going and talking to parents of two-year-olds, all the way to the kind of stuff that I would approach. I have a family medicine resident right now doing a qualitative analysis, interviewing clients, finding patterns and understandings. So all along that spectrum, you're in a great position to affect change. And there are lots of physicians now that are foraying into policy efforts. So it's an oyster as long as you respect the fact that you need to listen to the people who are most vulnerable to this.
And I think if you push your institutions a bit to have some strong partnerships, you can sometimes help people where you've identified a problem but don't have the longevity or the skill set to respond to it. And even in private practice situations, but especially in FQHCs, the health centers or the hospitals, there are often resources that are not connected to other parts of the system, and then certainly the community resources where it takes time and effort to get to know who's out there, but once you have that partnership and are able to make referrals and make connections, you can really. But writing a prescription for Big Brother, Big Sister, which will put Big Brother, Big Sister on the spot because they have a waiting list, I'm sure, but is part of the way that I think providers can start making some connections that are really important. We don't have to see ourselves as the answer, but push for that broader connection. And there are hospitals with child abuse prevention programs and intimate partner violence prevention programs, and those programs don't work with each other, even though the comorbidity is 30, 40%. So it's a really system question that you kind of asked as well.
Yeah, I would partly second that and say the best chance for you to contribute something is to try to look for opportunities where you currently are to make change. And even if it's a small change, but something incremental. I say the flip side of that is to try to avoid getting caught up in the polarizing arguments and debates around issues of firearms. Because we've been in that, and we go in circles on this one, and it doesn't, not only doesn't get us any place, if anything, it further alienates the people we need at the table to be part of this discussion.
Okay, our next question, thank you.
Hi, I missed the first talk, sorry. So maybe you already went over this, but I was wondering if you could comment on the Dickey rule and how that's impacted the Dickey rule, the J. Dickey, that no research on gun violence at the CDC, and how, am I wrong? And how is that still in effect, and how that's affected research on gun violence? Thank you.
Well, this is I actually had the Dickey Amendment in my talking points, and it was edited out. So that's all I have to say about that matter.
I think Dr. Spivak spoke in general to some of the considerations, but I will say that even in state government, from my time in Sacramento, at Oshpad, where we did some research, it was actually known that gun violence research was a very difficult area to investigate, and that there was a lack of support and a lack of enthusiasm for it, and people tended to turn elsewhere for their research careers. Dr. Prothrostith.
Well, that is true, and it wasn't always the case. So there was a time early on, I would say maybe the first 10 years, when CDC was very actively funding firearm research. And then politically, the climate changed, and we were actively involved when Congress went through and scratched out every part of the CDC budget that had the word firearm in it, totaling $2.6 million for the injury center there. And since then, and you spoke, Howard spoke to the private sector even becoming kind of gun shy or gun research shy, but certainly the public sector after that stopped funding the research. And some of our colleagues, Kellerman and Wintermute and some others, were actually harassed for
Art Kellerman was blackballed, actually, and couldn't get federal funding for a number of years. Let me just say one thing on this, and that is, as a parent, you learn that it's often better to go in the back door than the front door when you're trying to deal with an issue like with your child. I think the same is probably true with firearm research, and the best way to approach firearm research is not to go in the front door of it, but to integrate firearm research into violence prevention research, so that you're doing it, but you're doing it in a context which, for me, is more relevant anyway. And more realistic and more functional anyway.
Next question, sir. Oh, Dr. Dickey, did you want to?
Just really briefly, I would second that and look at it in a very optimistic way. It's an opportunity to be really creative with a small amount of dollars.
Indeed. Yes, thank you. Next question.
Hi, thanks for coming. My name is Sam Blake. I'm a dual degree MBA, Master's in Public Policy student here at UCLA. And I've done some work in the gun policy area, and I am, thinking about how so much of this gridlock and circularity and lack of progress, a lot of it comes down to, at the policy level anyway, the gun lobby and their kibosh that they put on research and so forth. And in thinking about new approaches, like this backdoor approach and getting voices to the table to be able to make progress, I'm interested in basically the psychology of gun ownership, why people want to own guns. Less so, which was already spoken about, kind of in the super high violent, vulnerable areas, but more so with respect to that powerful lobby. And I feel like that might be an opportunity to find a backdoor into developing policy that can appeal to, these psychological motivations. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I'm not going to answer your question, but I'll give others time to think while I make one point, actually relative to the former comments, and it's about guns in the larger context of violence, and so it is a little bit related to your point. One of the things that's interesting is that we watched some of the statistics around girls change in this country. Anecdotally, they were fighting more. We heard from elementary and high school teachers about girls fighting. And the arrest rates started going up for girls in some really dramatic ways. But what was interesting is that girls were not using guns the way boys were using guns, and even the data surveying teenagers about weapon carrying, it was very clear that weapon carrying and gun carrying in particular was a boy thing and not a girl thing. And that, to me, spoke to the issue of culture and what it means to have a gun and why people get guns and who's supposed to use a gun and who's not. And I do think there's a lot to learn in that regard. But for me, it really speaks to putting guns in the larger context of violence prevention. Because when we first got started, stabbing deaths were the leading cause of deaths in the young black male population of Philadelphia, for instance. And that has certainly shifted to guns. But it means something to have a gun, and it means something to use a gun, and it means something to feel like a gun is protecting you. There's some qualitative information about how people respond to situations if they have a gun or if they don't have a gun. But I think this is the beginning of our understanding a little bit more about those, you know, nearly 400 or 350 million guns that we have in this country. Because some of them are great-grandfather's, you know, rifle that's here. And then a lot of them are people who get 12 and 14 and 20 and 30, and they're stockpiling. There's a very different context, if you will. But even using a gun or carrying a gun is very, very different culturally.
Dr. Dicker.
I'll just make a couple comments. I lived in Vermont for a short period of time. I grew up in LA. I'm a Valley girl. And I'm sorry. I don't know why I feel like I always have to apologize for that. But I went to Vermont, and some of my classmates had rifles and guns, and I just started getting into the immediate conversation. Why would you do that? And there's so much about the culture of hunting in some areas in New England, in particular. That's what I know, that I came to understand, and that they use the whole deer. And I came to understand what that was about and how it was a bonding experience. But they didn't necessarily think that lobby groups represented them. But I started to understand the reasons that I didn't before growing up in Southern California, why some people had guns. The other thing that was really amazing to me is about a month ago, the American College of Surgeons Committee on Trauma, the group that I mentioned in my talk that mandates criteria for trauma centers, met with the NRA leadership. And I thought I thought it was amazing that they were able to get a meeting. They had tried for about a year. I'm not part of the Committee on Trauma Leadership, but they had a conversation that ended up, the neutral territory was illegal guns. And they had, just as an informational perspective, the NRA is like, we need to do something. And who do we partner with about all the illegal guns? And we want ownership to be legal. And it was just the first sort of conversation I had heard someone representing me as a surgeon having with the NRA that actually sounded like there was going to be a relationship there somewhere where we could actually have dialogue. They exist, and you know, dialogue is a good thing, I think.
I just want to add one comment, and it's a comment, it's not an answer. There's a very complex belief system around gun ownership in this country that is not rooted in reality, but it is a very powerful belief system where perception is reality. And there, a big element of this is that people truly believe that owning a gun, especially a handgun, is a protective behavior, that you can protect your family, that you can protect yourself. And I think we have to understand that better, because I think there probably are social marketing strategies that can be applied to that to help people better understand it. Because I think if we can even shift that belief system a little bit so that people won't give that up completely but understand the risks of gun ownership along with that belief system, that we'll begin to see some change. And we'll probably see fewer guns in the illegal market because they'll be stored in a way where they're less easy to steal. People will keep track of them better. A whole variety of potential outcomes in this. But the belief system's pretty powerful, and you can't blame the lobby groups for this. This is long-standing in this country.
Yeah. There are other countries where long guns, army guns, are pretty much in every household, and there's a system of locking and checking and being responsible for the guns, and they don't have our homicide rates. Many of the Scandinavian countries where there's a volunteer army, you'll find that. What I think is really sort of interesting is the complexity around guns and some of those reasons why people have them and some of the mythology about what it means to have one. Mr. Owen spoke about that notion that it was a way of having power. And our media, particularly our entertainment media, really plays into that, that if you have the biggest gun or you have the gun, you have the power, you can solve the problem, you can, you know, rectify the wrong. And, that's just a part of it. I remember being at a board meeting of the Brady group, and one member of the board mentioned that when watching television during the Katrina hurricane, there was a sense that if she had been there, she would want a gun because it was mass chaos and there was no protection and people were isolated. And what I reflected on there was two things. One is that there are kids who feel like that every day when they walk outside their house just to go to school. And that it's interesting that even someone who is actively involved and supporting financially and otherwise efforts to do gun control had a point at which a gun was the answer. And I think it just speaks to how complicated it is. And each of us has a place where we can go where all of a sudden we feel like, okay, I'm gonna beat you up for doing that thing to me, whatever that, you know, that thing is. So even the subject of violence and violence prevention is nuanced and complicated and cultural. You know, what happens on the football field, if it happened on the street, you know, people could get arrested. And I think it's, you know, spanking children is another example of what is clearly violence. However, it is sanctioned in a way for some. So this is a very complicated piece, and then you throw in self-defense out of fear, and it gets even more nuanced. I think you should continue your pursuit, because there's a lot to add from that kind of qualitative look at.
I also just want to second something that was said a little earlier, which is recreational firearm use can be fun. I mean, I took riflery as a kid. My son did it at camp. In fact, I went to visit him at camp, and he took me to the rifle range, and he handed me the rifle like he was going to show me, you know, like he was at a cocky age, and I like hit the target every time, and his jaw dropped. He said, "Dad, you're like a violence prevention person." So I think we have to be focused on the right things here,
right.
And there's nothing wrong with safe use of firearms in a recreational context, and we've got to be clear about that too.
I think cars are an interesting analogy for guns. There's risk, there's benefit. As a society, we've decided that the benefit is worth the risk, but here's how we're going to control the risk. And I think with the absence of data around firearms, it's very hard for us as a society to start talking about how that risk can be controlled. But clearly with guns, as a society, we've decided that the benefit is worth the risk. And what we probably need to translate into now, or transition into, is this notion of how do we minimize that risk and get the data to help us understand that.
Let's go ahead and take our next question. Dr. Wells.
Hi. First, I want to thank the panel for your very thoughtful comments. And then I have a quick comment and a follow-up question for you. The comment is, some of us here participated in a partnered randomized trial of approaches to deliver mental health services for depression in under-resourced communities, especially communities of color. And we compared supporting individual programs with resources to deliver depression services, or bringing everyone together in a collaborative, from barbershops and senior centers to clinics. And for those clients who were depressed and justice involved, there was, unexpectedly for us, predicted by the community, a main effect on reducing arrests and probation. And the reason I mention that is it echoes a number of the themes that you all have brought up around partnership, community engagement, social determinants, going beyond, and also it takes a village. So my question is, since you've all been there, you've all taken that kind of stand, devoted a career, recovered yourself, provided leadership, and so forth, what are your lessons? What are the strategies for people here to follow those kind of complicated paths, addressing social determinants, reaching out to the community from largely health roles that are, you're taught to be more restricted? So what are the strategies, the lessons, to provide the kind of leadership you have provided?
I think one of the social engagement piece, or a community outreach piece, is for at least with gangs, is to have an understanding that gangs aren't insurgents, and they don't fall out the sky, they don't come from another planet. They are part of the community. They go to the schools, they live there, they shop there, they're part of the community, they're your neighbors. So one of the pushes that I have, and thank God for technology, it's wonderful, it's great, but when we come into a realm of social media and we disregard our next door neighbor, so we might have 733 friends on social media, but we don't know the 12 people that live on our street, there's a disconnect from our community. So I think that the outreach within our community, and social media is a community, but our actual community where we live, the next city over, whatever it might be, whether it's the park, or it's a youth program, whatever it might be, get involved, do some sort of outreach, take a peek at what they're doing, and you can have a hands-on view as to what that life is like.
Great.
I would just add one comment to that. I think from a leadership perspective, it's so important really to pay attention to some of the work that's been done around the great integration of peer counselors with mental health services, until, frankly, we can start bringing up preschoolers that are coming from most affected communities to be those mental health professionals. We're struggling right now. We have a job opportunity open. It's been open for 6 months for an in-house mental health specialist for the Wraparound Project, and we just haven't found a great fit yet. But there is really great data to support that sort of a partnership with peer counselors and mental health specialists to not only bring people in where and erase some of the stigma about mental health, but keep people engaged in the care. It's been working really well, and there's some manuscripts out there that you're probably very familiar with to support it.
I will just put in a plug for the soon-to-start psychiatry residency program at Charles Drew that will specialize with SPA 6 as its geographic area in, you know, culturally competent care integrated into the community. July 2018 is when we expect to have our first set of residents, but even integrating mental health into health is a substantial challenge. And fortunately, LA County has really put DMH and DHS and DPH under one umbrella. So there's the opportunity to really begin to do that. What you cited is a great example of the benefit of that.
I also think we need a bit of a paradigm shift here as well, and we have to stop thinking that we have to do things for communities and start doing things with communities, and recognizing that most communities have incredible strength within them, and building that strength is really important. Too often, we fail to recognize that, and we descend on communities to try to fix them, and that doesn't work. And I think that paradigm shift is happening. It needs to move faster.
Thank you. Next question. Yes.
Hi, my name is Melissa Breimer. I have a comment and a question. The first, my comment is the first question was talking about what kind of training or materials are available as it relates to child trauma. I just want to say that UCLA and Duke University runs the largest child trauma network, and we're funded by SAMHSA, and we're currently funded with 81 centers. And our centers are hospitals, they're mental health centers, they're schools, they're child welfare, juvenile justice. And we do look at who's serving those kids. So we have curricula that's all free, that's for juvenile justice, that's for resource parents, for educators. So if you Google Child Trauma Network, you'll be able to get some of those resources, and it will link to our online learning center if you're wanting to learn some of these pieces. So the piece that I'm particularly interested in, and it goes to some of your comments from you, Ben, in terms of with kids, kids know that they need help sometime, but no one ever asks them. And so we're waiting for kids to take the initiative when they're waiting for us to actually reach out. And sometimes we're finding in the work that we're doing with child trauma, we're talking a lot about violence and abuse, but we haven't mentioned once that grief or traumatic separation, or a parent being imprisoned or separated because of legal issues that are going on, that how do we even have schools or pediatricians or the different child serving systems ask, have you had a recent loss? Have you had a recent death? Or what's that question that would have helped you to maybe ask for support or get guidance? And how do we start that conversation? Because there's one thing about programs, another of making sure that we ask those questions, so.
Yeah, I think if I had been asked that question by a teacher or by a mentor, someone in the community, I probably would have taken a different approach, because it would have been an indication of care, that somebody was concerned about my welfare, my well-being. Beyond that, everything that I was experienced to me in my mind was normal. So when you live in a population where 70%, 75%, 80% of the homes or single home parents, or you know, young men aren't raised with their fathers, it's normal. When you get whoopings, it's normal. When you peed in the bed and you get a whooping, it's normal. When your mother gets beat, it's normal. When you get shot, it's normal. When you get jumped in the gang by four guys and they break your jaw, it's normal. So it would be refreshing for someone to ask me that, because it would give a sense of care, and it would at least would have put in my mindset that this is not normal, because I actually have someone asking me that, not because they're intrigued by it, but because this is not normal.
You know, I used to do a lot of presentations to teachers, and invariably, if I didn't bring it up, a teacher would bring it up and say, well, what do I do with these kids who are acting out, and they're disrupting my class, and how do I discipline them? And my response was always, don't discipline them. Ask them what happened at home that morning. Because if you ask these kids, they'll tell you. Yeah. And they know what's going on, but they're not going to offer it. And the more opportunities we create for kids to know that somebody actually is concerned about when what happened to them can dramatically change. It's part of this this process of trauma-informed care is not reacting, but listening and asking.
And when you have a toxic environment, when the society is toxic, from the entertainment media through to the things adults say, like, go back out there and beat them up, or I'm going to beat you, and guns are available, and you are witnessing and experiencing violence, then you're even more vulnerable. And there are settings outside of homes where we have the opportunity to ask that kind of question, to make that kind of connection, to offer the mentor, the big brother, big sister, the program, just the care and concern. And doctor's offices are one of the places that can happen. The school is another, the public health department is another, the church and religious institutions. And I think that what keeps coming to my mind is Joy Dreyfus's book, Within Our Reach. This is something we can do. And often it doesn't take much in the way of resources or exotic activity. Often what it takes is often right around us. It's just a matter of asking that question and making those connections and really being prepared to offer a response.
Just an endorsement. Folks should go out and get Joy Dreyfus's book on schools as multi-service centers. It's an incredibly wonderful book, and she wrote it a long, long time ago. But it's really terrific.
Well, at this point, it's the moderator's point in time to say one last question, and we actually have 1 minute left in this session. So please make the question quick and the responses quick as well. Thank you.
My name is Leanne. I'm a third-year medical student in the MD-PhD program here. I wanted to thank you guys, first of all, for speaking here today. I had a kind of two-part question. I'll try to make it quick, but the first one was directed to Ben Owens, who has, you know, been through this experience, and the second one is more for those of us who are outside of it and trying to help those who have been through it. For Ben, I was wondering what inspired or stimulated your conversion from a top gang member into a gang prevention mentor, because you had mentioned that transition, but you didn't really talk about the motivation behind it. And I guess my second question for everyone else is, like, you've mentioned a dearth of research regarding violence prevention. So given that, like, how did you decide what program strategies you wanted to try? And also simultaneously, how do you justify those to funders or other people?
Ms. Rollins.
So my transition point came about, again, as I became sober, changed my life, dedicated to God. And the leadership role to be able to help others was really by appointment. You know, sometimes people will appoint you to do things that you didn't necessarily nominate yourself to do. So I don't know if that's a blessing or a curse, but I couldn't get out of it. People took interest into my credibility and my leadership and decided that this is the realm of work that I need to be doing.
Thank you. And the second question, anyone? Or no one?
Well, I have a quick response. A lot of the work in violence prevention is community-based, community engagement. And one of the things that I've learned is that you kind of start where the community is, where people are asking the question. You know, in some situations, the 911 calls for domestic violence far outnumber the 911 calls for gang violence by a lot. In that community, as you are working with people, they may be more concerned about gang violence. Now, your data showing the intimate partner violence problem may be compelling, but if you don't connect where that group of people is most concerned, then you miss an opportunity, because ultimately all of those types of violence are connected. So you can get to your data at some point if you really do work where people are and start addressing their concerns. So that's one of the ways of deciding where to begin. You might want to take this program that's been shown to be effective, you know, in community A and just replicate it in community B. But you get to community B and there's a different context. And violence is so contextual and so cultural that you really have to have that ear. You really have to listen. You really have to be that partner that can say, here's a program, but let's see what's going on and how would you do this and is this even the right one? Maybe there are some others out there. So I kind of start there. But if you're a trauma surgeon, then there's another window that reflects. I mean, I think what you bring to the table is also part of the equation.
Two quick answers. One is there is a website called crimesolutions.com that you can use, which has an evidence base of about 500 programs with some degree of significant evidence. A list of programs alone isn't the answer, but at least it's a starting point. So I would, number one, recommend that. The second thing is, just by example, when Deborah and I started our violence prevention work in Boston, we spent almost the first 2 years not doing anything except pounding the pavement and meeting with people. And both of us spent more time in community rooms and housing projects and basements of churches and stuff than at least I, as a nice Jewish boy, ever thought I'd ever spend. But God, if we hadn't done that, I don't know that we would have even known where to start. And so,
or had the partners that we had in that. That was the
other. You can't shortchange a good process before you start diving into stuff.
Well, that's a good way to end the conversation, and I apologize. We have to move on with the agenda. But let's have a round of applause for our panelists. And thank you very much, Ben Owens, Howard Spivak, Deborah Prothero-Stith, and Rochelle Dicker for some great comments. We heard from Dean Prothero-Stith about a public health perspective on gun violence. We heard from Mr. Owens about, I think, a very personalization about being directly connected and exposed to this environment that is so challenging and how he surmounted it. Of course, we heard from our esteemed trauma surgeon who's on the front lines every day in a very challenging environment, how she's actually, I think, transcended that in some ways and developed a program that can sort of prophylax against gun violence very effectively. And of course, I think we heard from our policy leader, Howard Spivak, about how policy can and maybe has not always been able to address some of the challenges before us. At this point, we're pretty much done, but I do want to say, again, on behalf of the Board of Advisors for the Healthcare Symposium, I want to recognize all the Board of Advisors. If you're one of the advisors, please stand up and be acknowledged. I want to recognize our student directors because they might not recognize themselves. So student directors, please stand up and be recognized. And we have some distinguished sponsors as well. And especially, I want to say thank you for all of you being here and participating with rapt attention today. Of course, this is our 21st annual UCLA Healthcare Symposium, and I just want to thank everyone for being here and our directors for a job well done. I hope that we've inspired you toward a greater understanding of an involvement in working together to eliminate what is a scourge of gun violence, a blight that challenges our society. I think the question that we all should ask, and one that was raised a bit earlier, is what can each of us, what can each of you do to address this? What can we do today? What can we do right now? Because obviously this is an ongoing situation. So finally, I also challenge you to work at the intersection of healthcare, health policy, and public health, because that's where it's at when you want to bend the curve of health in the United States. That's where you've got to be working. Recognize, as I've said a lot, the patients that are beyond our walls. It's all too easy just to focus on the patient in front of you and forget about the environment that they come from. Remember, as I think you heard Dean Prothero-Stith say, that primary and secondary prevention are just as or even more important than tertiary medical care. And to think of society and its health as our patient, not just the individual. So thank you very much, and I'll turn things over to our student directors to wrap things up. Great being here with you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for sticking to be here. This is the moment that everyone has been waiting for. I'm going to be drawing the raffle prizes. So first, we'll be starting with the Target gift card. If your name is called, please come up to the stage. Ada? Ada H. Peter? Peets or Peter? No? Okay. Keep drawing until they come up. Robert Bang? Yay! Okay, next I'll be drawing from the Starbucks gift card jar. Is this Beth Perry, Dr. Perry? Oh, Ruth, yes. Sorry, I couldn't read your handwriting. I'll be drawing two from the Kaplan Step 1 prep jar. The first will be for the three-month access. There's a blank one. Paul Camarena. Yay. And then the next one will be a 12-month access, QBank. Edwin Rashidi.
Hi, everyone. Please bear with us for a couple more minutes. Now we want to give the student thank yous to everyone who helped us put together this morning. So when I say your name, please come to the stage. We have a small gift that we've prepared for you. So first, we would like to thank our Board of Advisors for sharing their insight and wealth of experience throughout this entire planning process. So first, we have Dr. Patrick Dowling. Okay. Next up, we have Dr. Edmund Hewlett. And finally, Dr. Kenneth Wells. He stepped out? Okay. So we also want to acknowledge the advisors who were unable to join us this morning, including Drs. Mitchell Katz, John Mazziota, and Gerardo Moreno. So next, we would like to thank our speakers who have truly inspired us with their messages today. So we have a gift for Dr. Prothero-Stith. Mr. Ben Owens, Dr. Rochelle Dicker, Dr. Howard Spivak, and now we would like to thank our moderator, Dr. David Carlisle, who kept today running nice and smoothly and summed up today. And last but not least, we want to thank our wonderful faculty advisor, Dr. Clarence Braddock. Words cannot describe how privileged we felt to have been able to work with you this entire year, and we will really miss you.
Oh, you're not rid of me yet. Lastly, we would like to thank all of you for being a part of this discussion here today. Please join us outside on the terrace for lunch. You may go through the doors on the, in the promenades on either side of the ballroom where breakfast and registration took place. Thank you.